are you going to see a gap that big? Dude, this is Nitro Rallycross. Let's get ready to send it!
It all comes down to this final stop of the Nitro Rallycross Championship here at the Firm in North Florida. And the battle for the NRX title is down to three contenders separated by the slimmest of margins. The visionary and series leader, Travis Pastrana, has to stay loose and drive fast to complete the mission. His teammate, Scott Speed, has the experience and multi-surface mastery that has put him in the literal driver's seat with his battle bracket win yesterday. Can the Team Subaru drivers extinguish the desire and focus of Team Timmy Hansen, who also has a legitimate shot to win here today and take the crown? To do it, they will need to conquer this pack of 15 drivers that includes 2020 NASCAR Superstar Champion Chase Elliott through Firm's Florida Woods and its multi-surface track of epic airtime and high-speed racing. We are chasing down history with the first ever NRX Series Championship title on the line. The stars of Nitro Rallycross are ready to send it here in North Florida. I'm Jared Deanda alongside Andrew Coley. This track has the makings of absolutely deciding who the champion. It's the longest track. It's the most, I mean, I don't want to say it's the most exciting, but it's the most exciting right now. Andrew, you're sweating, man. I feel like you're about to go for the championship.
Mate, I am so nervous. We're doing battle around this incredible track here. How are the drivers feeling? If I'm feeling nervous, I always feel like it's on game day. This is championship day for NRX Supercar, for NRX Next as well. Both are going down to the very last race of the season. Tarmac and dirt. We've got so much more pavement here than we've had anywhere else, and that's maybe going to play into the hands of Scott Speed and Timmy Hansen. They focus on that a bit more. Travis has kind of openly said, I don't really like it. So, I mean,
he's been saying that from round one.
Yeah.
He's like, whenever I touch asphalt, I know Scott, and he's shown him so many things. And I'll tell you what, Travis has given Scott so much credit, but now here they are, one and two.
It's funny, somebody said to me this morning that the other drivers are lucky they didn't turn up this morning and find 100 tons of clay had been put over the over the pavement, because that would have, you know, played to Travis's. But it's awesome. You know, it's going to be a brilliant fight. We've got three drivers going for it. I can't wait.
So three heats. It's a brand new format. So previous rounds, you've had two heats, right? So now the grid is going to be established across three heats. Notably, again, Scott Speed gets that win yesterday. So race one, Travis Pastrana. It's a must win for Travis Pastrana. He's got Kevin Hansen. The other Hansen brother is going to shake things up. Heat two, what do we got?
Timmy Hansen on pole in this one. So Timmy and Scott, where they made it to the final of the battle. So there are three heat races. If they win their heat race, they will occupy the front row. So Travis must win that first race, and then he really needs Timmy in heat two and Scott in heat three, both to lose their races. Then he goes to the front row. If one of them loses, he goes front row. If they both lose, he gets pole. But we know these guys are pros on pavement, so that's a big ask. So he has to do his job, and then he has to wait and see if they can do theirs.
And the Hansen boys are saying their cars are built for this track. Travis even said it. This is kind of a European rallycross setup, and I think that really speaks to the Hansens are a threat. This is the point standings, 184. Look at that. 6 points separate Travis and Scott. And as, excuse me, 5 points. Yeah, again, we'll stick to announcing, not math. And Scott Speed, Timmy Hansen, Kevin Hansen. It really, I mean, so much fate is lying in the other racers' hands as opposed to Travis Pastrana. We caught up with a lot of the drivers, so here's what they had to say about this epic day here at Nitro Rallycross.
All right, Travis, so first one for you really is, what is it going to take to get this done today? There's a lot on the line.
A lot on the line. We were fourth fastest all day yesterday. Unfortunately, that didn't really set us up very great for today. We're not out of this hunt by any means, and didn't go with the points lead. But it's going to take a perfect drive for me. And on pavement, that's been difficult in the past. I usually do better when the pressure's on, and the pressure is on. We got to do a perfect day, starting with Kevin Hansen, who has been driving very well all weekend. So I need to win that first heat to keep it in my own hands for this championship.
Well, all I can do is what I can do. So I got to start pole for my heat race. First objective, we need to win that. That puts us in on pole for the final and in the best possible chance. And hopefully we can go out there and do the same thing in the final, get us two wins. And I think if we do that, like, Trav's going to, it's a tough road to finish second from there for him, which you'd have to do to win. So we're going to keep focused on the 41 car and do the best we can. Also with a mind that, you know, Travis and I are our team, so Subaru winning is still the goal, so we'll also keep that in mind as we go through the day.
I think for me it's quite simple. Have to have a good race and win the race. So there is really not much else on my mind, you know, trying to have a clean start and a clean race and go as fast as we can, get that win, and then we'll see how the others end up and if the Subarus fighting each other or, you know. But, yeah, I'm just going to try to enjoy this. It's the last Rallycross day of the year. It's been a great season. I'm happy about this year, no matter how this goes now. So, yeah, trying to enjoy it. I've got nothing to lose, so all in.
I love that. And, you know, coming, Timmy Hansen kind of had some spirited words yesterday about kind of the stewards getting involved with his race. But I think he kind of maybe regrets maybe taking those words back. But regardless, he's had a great season. He should definitely hold his head high. I mean, amongst all the races, what are your thoughts?
He is the one with nothing to lose. He's,
right.
He's far enough back that there's nothing he can do except go for it. So, yeah. He's the long shot. But
yep.
Therefore, no pressure. But these guys, the pressure's on big time.
Yeah, look at that. You can see Travis. Don't know what he's doing right now, but Will Christian caught up with him right before he jumped in the cockpit behind his Subaru.
Thank you, Jared. And the pressure is on. It's time now, Travis. It's time to get out there. You're leading in points, but there's a lot of work left to do today. How are you feeling? Is a guy like you feel the pressure?
Yeah, pressure is that's definitely where I shine. That's where we do the best. But, you know, I know we have a great car. Scott's proven that. But I got to figure out how to drive pavement. And I've done more studying and more homework than I've probably ever done in my whole life coming into this, up pretty much all night last night. But still having fun. Chase got we got a skydive in this morning. You know, it's awesome to see the fans out here. This track is definitely the most like the European Rallycross track. It's the most pavement that we've had. It's the least amount of jumps that go into the flow of the course. So it takes a lot of my strengths out, but we got to get it done today, and I think we can do it.
Now, the team, Subaru, obviously, we're looking at a potential 1-2 here. They have not done that before. They haven't achieved that before. So what would it mean to you? What would it mean to the team to get this done today?
Subaru has never won an American Rallycross Championship, and I've never won a Rallycross Championship of any kind. So, you know, for me, this is huge. And to be in the hunt is awesome. You know, Scott's my teammate, but he's still really helped me. He wants to beat the best me that he could beat. And I think that's awesome. You know, it's the camaraderie here and the yin and yang, really, with Scott, who's such a perfectionist, and myself, who's the opposite of that. We've really helped complement each other well. Unfortunately, right now, I got to learn how to drive like Scott, and I got to do it the best of my ability. But this team looking pretty good to win the overall team championship over the world champion Hansen team, I think it is pretty impressive.
It's very impressive. I'm excited. I'm the fans. Can't wait to see you out there, Travis. Best of luck today.
Thank you so much, Will. And, you know, the drivers are nervous. Coley, you're nervous, man. I mean, you're up all night. You were up late last night just thinking about and dwelling on this thing, man.
I love this sport, and I get fully invested in it.
It's
and
great.
I know, you know, the emotions the drivers are going through, you feed off it. You know, this is going to be a great day today. I hope we see some really good, clean racing. And, yeah, crown a great champion.
So what's at stake here? Well, let's take a look at the grid first. Kevin Hansen, Travis Pastrana, they are on the front row. Robin Larson, Kevin Erickson, and then bring up the rear. Follow the ham. Kevin Bigham is there in that third row. So how many laps are we going to see, and what's at stake?
So only the winner of this goes through. It's absolutely critical for Pastrana to beat Kevin Hansen. Otherwise, he's going to definitely be back a row. And then after that, actually, Travis's fate is in the hands of Scott Speed and Timmy Hansen. If they don't win, he can get onto the front row. He just needs one of them not to win. But he has to win this first. Otherwise, he's going to the semi-final. Don't forget, Pastrana has won every heat race he's done so far this year. He's gone straight to the final. Can he do it when it really counts? Here we go. Pastrana with a great start on the outside. Behind him, Robin Larson coming to the jugular time. Behind Kevin Hansen, Pastrana can't run away through there. He might go the long way round. Go straight to the jugular at the Subaru. Hanging on round the outside. Little nudge to Kevin Hansen. Pastrana goes straight to the Joker. In behind goes Kevin Erickson as well. Travis has run a little bit deep there, Jared, and Kevin will try to capitalize on this next lap.
Yeah, you can see Travis Pastrana going for that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. But look at that. He is really throwing a lot of angle at it, which is taking speed out of the car, taking momentum. And look at that. Already Hansen has, I mean, look at that, 6.7 seconds. That's not too bad, though.
The delta yesterday between the Joker lap and the standard lap, remember, you have to take the Joker once in each race, was about 6.2. But they just wanted the track, Jared, and looking at the angle Travis was at, it was more slippery than he thought. So it might be that Kevin Spotter will now be on the radio going, watch it in the Joker, it's slippery. So is he going to stay out? Look, the gap's now 6.5, so they'll be making that decision on the fly. Are they going to leave him out, or are they going to respond to Travis's Joker on lap one?
And there we are, right along with Travis Pastrana. You can see the running order. Kevin Hansen, Larson, Bigham, Pastrana, and Erickson. Only Pastrana and Erickson have taken the Joker lap. But here is Hansen leading out front. He's going to try to gain more ground. and create a larger gap between him and Travis, and of course Larson and Bigham. But all eyes are really fixated on the battle between Hansen and Pastrana.
6.2. Travis Pastrana just took 0.3 seconds, 0.3 crucial tenths of a second out of Kevin Hansen. He has to beat him, Jared. He's got to do that again on the next lap. Yesterday, Travis was kind of overdriving a bit and losing time. As you see Cabot Bigham come out through the joke lap on the brilliant drone shots there. Pastrana's got clear air in front of him. He can do this, but he's got to drive clean.
Yeah, he's got to get up there. He's got to close that gap. And I'll tell you what, yesterday when he went against Scott Speed, he overcooked it. He really dug the front of that Subaru into the landing of the jump. The jump that he just executed, absolutely flawless. You saw him just land, really masterclass, really well done.
Gap's gone up by 0.4. They told him on the radio that it was 6.9. It's actually 6.6. They're almost certainly using a stopwatch up there. Sounds really analog, but they can do the splits whenever they want then. So they've told Travis this has got to be a good lap.
And I'll tell you what, the spotters don't have eyes on that far side of the track. Like right here when they come out of the woods, the spotters can't see what's going on back there. That's where we saw the incident between Chase Elliott and Tanner Faust. Look at Travis using all the doors, carrying that momentum out of the woods and then back onto the tarmac.
So it's 6.1, it's 6.1 into the background. Robin Larson's gone joker. Kevin Hansen goes over the top of the jump. So Kevin's going to go last at 6.1. He's got to keep that pressure on. It's gone both ways, Jared. Yeah. Up 0.5, down 0.5.
I mean, Larson, look at him. He's sitting in second. But the only spot that's critical, number one, because they're advancing on in two. Again, four laps. The one driver is moving on directly into the finals.
The right Kevin Hansen is hustling the Peugeot. So is Pastrana. He saw tires.
5-4.
Yes, they've come down. It's up by a tenth again. At the minute, Pastrana would get this done. They're both smoking up the tires on the exit. So be under no doubt at all that they are absolutely on the limit, both these drivers.
Now they're going to be approaching that white flag, meaning there is one final lap. And with a gap of 5.5, systematically, mathematically, Travis should regain the lead from Hansen because Hansen will be taking the joker lap because it's the final lap. Travis will be taking the jump. You'll see him potentially even maybe jumping over Hansen. Here comes the white flag. Is it the mercy flag? Or is it a checkered for Travis Pastrana? We will see. Hansen to Pastrana. Here we go.
They told Travis he had to push. He's really good on the dirt. He needs to keep it tidy in the first two corners. Kevin Hansen goes into the joker. How slippery is it for him? Pastrana 5.7. He said send it deep. Pastrana's going to go big over the gap. He goes long.
And he takes it.
Pastrana to the inside line. And he's got it.
Pastrana takes the lead from Kevin Hansen. And this is exactly what he needs to do. But watch. Don't count on Hansen just yet. Pastrana, he's going to throw out his elbow. But Hansen's going to attack. We saw this yesterday between Speed and Timmy Hansen. But now it's different Subaru and different Hansen.
Pastrana on board looking in the mirrors. Kevin Hansen is all over him. He's on your bumper. He's telling him he's on your bumper. There is no gap between them. He has to stay out front. This could be the difference between winning the title or not, what row he ends up on. It's still out of his hands with Speed and Timmy Hansen to come. But Kevin trying to make life difficult for him. Keeps the door shut. Going to try and keep the door shut again. Saying keep it shut. Keep it shut. Here we go.
Listen to his spotter. He says he's right on your bumper. Keep it clean. Here we go. Pastrana, one more jump. And he's going to get the win over Hansen, and he gets what he and he does exactly what he needs to do. Look at Pastrana.
Yes, he knew what that meant. Look at the team.
We got it done, boys.
Yes, he says we got it done, and that's we, not me. That's what it's all about.
Great work.
Look at the pressure, though, Jared. Look at the relief of the pressure. If you were under any doubt at all as to how much pressure Pastrana is feeling, you know, that's a big relief. And it's still not over. He's still in the hands of other drivers, but the first part is done.
I'll tell you what, you do not want a Hansen in rearview mirror. You can see him navigating around this track. And again, the Hansens come in very, not cocky, but just very confident with their vehicles.
You know, they're a couple of the best rallycross drivers in the world.
Absolutely.
Travis, you know, they won the team's championship in the world championship, and Travis knows that they're at that top level.
Let's take a look at it again. A great start from all the drivers, to be quite honest. All eyes were fixated on Pastrana and Hansen, and this is what he talked about. On that outside lane, go for the joker lap. Hansen, no, he's going to go for the jump and save it for the final lap.
Travis jinked left there, didn't he? Look how deep he went on the first corner. And then, again, if we stay with this, what's the rotation angle on the exit of here? So swings the Subaru in again. He's a little way further out than you'd expect him to be, and that's because it had just been watered. But luckily, it was the same for Kevin when he went joker later.
And this is how it stayed for a while here. Kevin Hansen out front. He's on a Sunday cruise, man. He's feeling confident, but he knows that he's closing that gap. It was at 6.2 and then went down to 5.4. That was great.
The gap went both ways, and the thing is, Jared, they'll be looking upstairs, and if Kevin's managed to extend the gap on lap one, the spotters go, okay, we're faster. Leave him out for four laps, and we'll have a two-second gap come the merge. They didn't count on Travis responding on lap three and closing the gap down again, so they might actually have taken it if they'd gone Joe Grelli, but they were convinced Kevin was faster. They left him out longer. Listen to the noise from the crowd in the background. It was a great move. I love the fact he said, go deep on the jump, you know, send it, and you've got this.
Full pull. And there you see Hansen sweating Pastrana. And you, when we go in car, you can see him, just the nerves. He's clinching that wheel. But he kept it tight. He used all the course, gained the momentum out of the woods. And that was right there. What do you think? You think, like you said, you can hear the fans screaming. Look at that. Absolutely loving it. And again, he is the unofficial mayor of Nitro Rallycross, but he still has to earn his victory. Even though he kind of curates it, he's got his hands, he's driving tractors. He hates his track more than any of them. But guess what? Right now he's loving it. He gets the win. And now, as you said early on the show, the fate lies in Timmy Hansen and Scott Speed's hand. He just wants them to not get the win, and he'll be on the front row. Let's throw it down to Will, who's with our winner now.
And we have Travis here right now, guys. Travis, oh my goodness, such an important start to the day. I can see right now, we can see the tension. We were looking at you there and the in-car cameras and stuff. How are you feeling coming off that one?
We needed this. This was to keep our championship hope alive. I've been fourth fastest all weekend, and to take down Kevin in that, that's really good for Subaru and the team championship. Keeps my hopes alive, probably starting second row inside. Man, it's just, I can't even tell you. We went with Matt Crafton and Paul Menard and everybody to try to help me with road racing. I'm not good on the pavement, always overdrive, and it's just so difficult for me to not want to just push on that right pedal. And Scott's been helping me out so much, even though we're still in this championship fight, and it's all on the line now. But I just couldn't say enough about Team Subaru. They've always been the underdogs, but I tell you what, this team with Scott leading the charge and now me leading the points, this is awesome. This is a dream come true.
Just a little snippet to get into your head here a little bit. Heading into that Joker there, when it was all coming down to that point, what was going through your head? What were the spotters talking to you about?
Well, that first lap, I had taken the Joker, and the gap was going the wrong way. And my spotter's like, dude, you know, Scott has proven it. You have the car. Calm down. Don't overdrive. Hit every line. Don't miss any lines. And I was the drive of my life on pavement, and we were going to need it. And just to come out just barely in front there, the Joker's tough because you take it the first lap, you're kind of in dust. We got really fortunate. That was a really good heat race. All the drivers were awesome. And, yeah, just really pumped to come out. This is my first pavement win, really, of any type, so I'm going to take it. Thank you.
Enjoy it, Travis. Thank you.
You can just feel the pressure, the gorilla, the 1,000-pound gorilla off his back, smiles among the pits, and now the work begins. Because there were no points at stake, it just means he's in the finals. But this is a huge confidence booster for him. He just said it. This is the best results on asphalt ever.
Yeah, you know, he went off and got some tuition this week on driving on asphalt to get into the thing of keeping the car tidy. I think for me, the onboard reaction was the one, the relief from Travis, because he's gone straight to the final again. Now, the problem this time is he will be row two if Timmy and Scott both win their races. But he did what he had to do, and that now puts the pressure onto Scott and Timmy. Because they know, because Travis has won, now I have to win if I want to keep him back a row. So that job done there applies the pressure to somebody else. Might have been the driver's life on pavement. He's going to need one more to take the title later on today. But he is in the final, and that's great.
Yeah, and taking a look at our second heat here, Timmy Hansen, he's going against Oliver Erickson, who says, you know what, these three heats didn't really ideally work out for me as well. Steve Arpin, who's definitely a contender. Chase Elliott, 2020 NASCAR champion, who really kind of gave it the beans yesterday. Unfortunately, didn't pay off. He didn't T-bone him. I called it wishboning him, and then ended up getting reversed. But then Ollie Bennett. So I'll tell you what, Pastrana is an Ollie Erickson, Steve Arpin, Chase Elliott, and Ollie Bennett fan right now, because if Scott Speed wins his, that means Subaru would be 1-2 on that front row. That would be absolutely monumental for Subaru and their team.
Yeah, it certainly would. That would be huge, and that would give Travis a great chance of taking the title. But Timmy Hansen will have words to say about that. Can he beat his Swedish compatriot Olli Eriksson to turn one? And what have Arpin and Elliott got to say? Hansen with a great start on the inside line. Eriksson goes backwards, little nudge in the corner. Oh, Arpin makes a move
nudge
into the back of Timmy Hansen alongside Eriksson. Arpin's making a really aggressive move here. Hansen, Arpin, Bennett all go straight to the standard lap. And onto the joke lap underneath has gone Ollie, and also Chase Elliott's gone in with him.
Look at Ollie Erickson going for that Joker lap. You said a little tap. That was more than one, two, three. That was three nudges. But again, racing incident won't be penalized. No,
that's just good hard rally cross. Yeah, the first one was just a little nudge, and then it was actually Arpin who came in hot behind. Good on Steve. Great start. Was aggressive in turn one. Really assertive, and he finds himself P2 now. So they've got to decide whether or not to respond to Ollie Erickson. Do they think, you know, the speed he's got is enough for them to respond to him now? I suspect they'll stay out another lap and see what the pace is like.
All right, so out front right now, Timmy Hansen and Pastrana and Speed are watching feverishly. Look at Hansen. Compared to yesterday, he seems a little more frazzled, but he's got Arpin who's chasing him down, who says he's got a lot of work to do. He's feeling confident, but he knows that, you know, he's going against a fierce contender.
Arpin's aired back out big time, hasn't he, on the tabletop. In Hansen has managed to gap him by five or six car lengths on the first lap. Timmy is a bit like Scott Speed. He's got that focus on winning a title. He's won titles before, and that's where Scott and Timmy have maybe got a little advantage over Travis. On board for the jump gives you a good idea of the perspective. Into the left, and now wait for the weight transfer. Flick it right, and then flat out over the next jump, the ZipRecruiter one.
Well, I'll tell you real quick here. It's not on camera, but let's take a look at Ollie Bennett. He tried to go up the jump. He lost speed, and he's actually just going backwards on the jump because he didn't have enough speed to make the gap. That's going to put him in last place. Also, notably, Chase Elliott, he's out there in that Go Nitro ZipRecruiter vehicle. And you know what? He's giving it all. 8.5 seconds. He needs to close that gap. There's Ollie Bennett just kind of crawling off course.
So Bennett won't be able to take the standard lap now. He won't get a penalty for that because the Joker lap's longer. And that's why, I mean, whatever the problem was, looks like it might have gone away. But he's a long way back. This is all about Timmy Hansen out front, trying to hold on to that front row position if you can. And the gap's going up to Ollie Erickson at every sector. So Jared, they're going to leave him out. Chase has gone around as well, so the only danger man now for Hansen is Arpin, and he's gapping him just a little bit.
All right, Timmy Hansen out front, Arpin right there. He's going to have to keep it really clean because he knows he's going against Timmy Hansen. And like you said, nothing to lose. Man, those cars are landing so smoothly, smooth like butter. Now, Arpin, 1.3 seconds back. We are on lap 3 of 4.
Here's a little heads up for you. So Timmy Hansen's best lap in this one is a 106.8, and Travis's was a 106.7. So, the other way around, Travis 106.7. So there's only a tenth in it. So that really was a great drive by Travis. He's got the pace. But Jared, if Scott and Timmy win, he still ends up on row two, and that's so frustrating for him.
I mean, that's why we said the fate lies in Timmy Hansen's hands, and also Arpin. He would really... absolutely pilling up for Arpin. Speaking of Arpin, Will, what do you got?
Jared, I think Steve Arpin would be pretty happy with the drive he's putting together right now. Just to fill you guys in, his team were there till 3 o'clock last night, came back at 9 o'clock this morning trying to figure out an engine issue that they had. That's all the information that they give me. They actually fixed it this morning. They've also been playing with their springs, trying to get a little bit of a stiffer feel for Steve. So he said he's been struggling, but given that, you know, he's doing pretty well to hang in here. So I think he'll be relatively happy with it.
Yeah, all things considered, that's great. But did you see Timmy Hansen? 106.4.
Yeah, absolutely.
So he's actually
nailed it. Yeah, he's nailed it. So that's the best lap of today so far in Supercar. And Hansen has put it in just when he needed to, basically at Joker time. Tell you what, Ollie Erickson was closer than I thought. Yeah. I think Erickson's actually got past Arpin. But yeah, Timmy, that's what they do. So they've been on the spot and said, this is the lap to push. You're going Joker next time. No mistakes. And it is exactly what Timmy's good at.
A few more turns for Timmy Hansen. He will get the victory. And he will get, with this win, he is guaranteed front row. He is guaranteed front row. If Scott Speed gets the win, he will have pole. And that means Travis Pastrana would go to second row, which is, you know, you got this great wall of legends right in front of you.
You could never count out Timmy. I know he is the long shot being those many points back, but anything can happen in rallycross. And putting yourself on the front row puts yourself in less chance of that anything happening. So Hansen over the jump, coming down the straight. He's going to go through to the front row of the final. Arpin and Erickson coming through close behind. Erickson did get P2. Job done for Timmy. Not so much relief from Timmy. I think he knew that was what he wanted to do. Maybe felt that, not hearing his audio there, probably Swedish anyway, knowing Timmy. But a great win for Hansen. And he keeps that title hope alive. So two of the three are through. It's whether or not Scott Speed makes it in the next one.
All right, so look at Timmy Hansen, just cool as ice again. The Swedish driver, very, very cool.
Hey, Kev, you want to hear from Timmy?
And we were you know, talking about, you know, just nothing to lose. Let's take a look back here. There were some shots fired there right from the get-go.
Yeah, Arpit. So it was Ollie Ericsson made a real aggressive move around the outside to the Joker, which was great. So he lost out, and he realized Arpit was turning right and on the brakes. So he fired the Fiesta around the outside off to the Joker. There you can see it from another angle. Brilliant. So that's that split-second decision. That's not when your spotter says go. That's when you go, I've lost this start. There's two cars in front. I'm going Joker now. And if you're going to go Joker, you want to be first into the Joker. That's what he was.
Look at how smooth those cars land compared to the Subarus. Again, they land even keel. The Subarus, like we talked about, nose down. And Chase Elliott, he has to go to the semifinals. Here he spins out in that Go Nitro car powered by ZipRecruiter. Chase Elliott, you see him hit the tire, spins out, but, you know, still a valiant effort.
It's so hard to pull that car back. If it's over-rotating and turning in a little bit more, to suck it back out of the apex is really difficult. And actually, to bang it into reverse and first that quickly, good skills. So Elliott's done well to recover, but he's going to have to go again in the semi-final. He'll want to make it to the final. I know he will.
Yeah, I'd love to see him out there. We asked him yesterday because, you know, we saw Kyle Busch, you know, in Arizona, right? And then Andreas Backrud got back in the seat behind the wheel at Glen Helen. I said, any pressure because Kyle, you know, made the final? He says, nah, it's all good. I just want to get out there. Just have some fun. And he had a great attitude, didn't he?
He did, yeah. He was enjoying the process of, you know, when you're a legend, and he's a NASCAR legend.
Yeah.
When you're that good at something, you go somewhere and it's really hard, particularly when it's driving that you're meant to be mega at. You know, there's something cool about trying to get that process and match up to the top guys. He didn't do it this time. It was Timmy Hansen who took the win from Ericsson and Arpin. Hansen goes through to the final. Everyone else going to go again later.
And with that fastest lap, that is one to watch. So hopefully the spotters are in the ears watching, you know, basically looking at all the data, looking at all the research and seeing how they can execute, because Timmy is guaranteed to be on that front line as we get set for our final Heat 3.
I think the track's getting a little bit quicker. It doesn't actually matter, Jared, because it's all about race position. But I think where Hansen's lap times, also looking at it, Ericsson and Arpin's lap times were 107.0s as well. So maybe remember that how slippery the Joker was after it had just been watered. He's maybe getting a bit quicker.
All right, so as Timmy steps outside of his vehicle, I'm going to throw it down to Will Christian. Will, what do you got?
Thanks, Jared. Yeah, as you can see, like you said, just stepped out of his car. Timmy, very important one for you there. You said you got a fight ahead of you today, but this is a good way to start, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a good way. It's a good run, a clean run. Yeah, I enjoyed that. So I think also pace-wise, we're quite a long way ahead of what Travis just did. So yeah, that feels really good for the finals.
Thanks so much. Congratulations on that, guys. I think, as you can see there, Timmy is business as usual today.
He is absolutely laser focused, right? It's shaken, not stirred.
He knows what he's got to do. He's made it to the final, and now it just comes down to one race later on today. It's six laps for the championship, and here's the third player.
No, that's not a photo. That's video. Just cool, calm, collected, and that's what Travis definitely credits Scott Speed to. You know, he just doesn't make mistakes. That's what he kept saying. He doesn't make mistakes. He doesn't make mistakes. Until he makes one. But, Travis, again, he's flying the Subaru flag, but he obviously would want to beat Scott Speed. Here are the winners from our previous rounds. Timmy Hansen kicked things off in Utah. Remember, undefeated from previous Nitro Rallycross, the standalone event, then going to Utah. And Travis really regretted inviting the Hansons to Nitro Rallycross. And then, guess what? Scott Speed wins. Travis got second. Remember that he did a shoey even with second place. And then Travis is back-to-back. He wins in Arizona, wins most recently in Glen Helen a couple weeks ago. And now, here we go. 30-second card is up, Coley. What needs to happen? What are the scenarios? Speed, Faust, Dorn, Baldins, and McConnell.
Well, Scott Speed has absolutely got to win this. We've said this about all three of them, but there's three in the fight, and there's only two slots on the front row. And, Jared, that's so critical in the final later today. So Speed knows that Travis has done an incredible drive on pavement. He said it was the drive of his life on that surface. Timmy Hansen was super calm and collected, and Scott's looking that way as well. He's up against his old teammate, Tanner Faust, one of the greatest American rallycross drivers there's ever been. So this is not a done deal. Oh, it's a good start on the inside line. It's got Speed. Tanner Faust goes back a little bit. Liam Doran coming up towards the top three. Sideways in turn one. Doran drops back. Inside him goes Fraser McConnell with a smoke from the rear as they dive off to the outside line. Tanner Faust's got a lot of smoke coming off that car. Contact between McConnell and Doran. And Doran's had to bail on the jump on the way up. He didn't think he had enough momentum after that contact. And he rolls back down. So disaster for Liam. But Scott Speed out front.
I'm seeing a ton of white smoke coming out of Tanner's car. I don't know if that's engine or if that's just contact of the fiberglass to the Yokohama tires. But Scott Speed is out front. He's doing a great job. He's getting a lot of ground quickly out of the gate. Dorn was ping-ponging off of cars. Wow.
That's a lot of smoke, isn't it? We did see contact in turn one, Jared. It's so hard to tell with rallycross cars. Yeah, the cooling is in the back for most of them as well. So, yeah, we're not sure what's up with Tanner's car. But, I mean, the big thing here is, look, it's 7.5 back to Tanner. He went Joker. Remember, that's the gap we've got to watch for. 6-point-ish. 6.1-ish we're looking at. And it's going up, look. It's gone up to 7.9 already. So Speed has got this, the hammer down, hasn't he?
Yeah, but now you know his father's saying, hey, Be calm, race smart, don't make mistakes. Look at Fraz McConnell. So Fraz might be a threat a little bit, but both of them have neither of them have taken the Joker lap.
Yeah, so McConnell basically 3.1 seconds back. They changed the engine on Fraz's car. If you remember yesterday in the battles, he just wasn't there, and he's been there all season, Jared. I think he's been the surprise of the year for many drivers. Have been like, wow, Fraser's quick. Travis said it, didn't he, earlier on as well. But they changed the engine. The car looks quick, but he was involved in turn one, and that just gave Scott a little bit of a head start. And now Scott's not having to drive on his mirrors. He can just take whatever line he likes, and he's gapped him by another 6 tenths.
Yeah, you can see 4 seconds. Yeah, so he is just doing what Scott does, and that's living up to his name. He's got the speed in his corner.
And not making any mistakes. Exactly what Travis said. Travis will be watching this. He'll know, you know, this is Scott responding. Travis is going to be road two. Assuming Scott gets the end, we don't want to give him the old commentator's curse. He's got a couple of laps to go, but just business as usual, isn't it?
Yep. And we saw this yesterday. You know, Scott just not making any mistakes. Him and Timmy Hansen getting into it. And Timmy,
good job, you're closing the gap.
It'll
be easy here, no mistake.
So we're hearing Vatana foul spotter there, just saying you can close the gap. P2 is on, and that's because they're within shouting distance to McConnell. Look, but there's only about 3 seconds between McConnell and Faust, so Faust has been closing that down. Unfortunately, there's no prize for second here, Jared. Only the one goes through. Having said that, I suppose the prize is front row in the semifinal, and that makes a big difference.
It does, actually. Yeah, that brings up a great point, because only one driver from each heat. So again, right now, if it ended and the finish line was here, Scott Speed would be on that front row with Timmy Hansen, Pastrana there in second row. But like you said, the remaining drivers go to the semifinals, which is another 4 laps. But we take 2 drivers from those semifinals, and then finally LCQ.
Yeah, so McConnell won't be unhappy if he's on the front row with Tanner. Yeah, he'd be looking to book a slot. There's loads of Jamaican fans here this weekend, and he'll want to put on a good show for them. Meanwhile, Speed, he's putting on a great show. What's he doing in terms of lap times? He's in the 106s, so he's bang on the pace of Hansen as well. Hansen, though, he's looking, 106.2. There's 2 tenths in it. Scott, though, has done the fastest lap. So, yeah, the track might be coming to him. A little bit deep in turn one. White flags out. It's the last lap. Fraser McConnell's going to have to go Joker here with Speed. So Speed's gone in. Watch the right-hand side. You can see from the drone. There goes McConnell in. And up and over the jump's going to go Tanner Faust. Not going to be close enough to challenge Scott Speed, but he is going to get in front of Fraser McConnell.
Yep, so Faust does get that second spot. Oh, look at this. And looks like Baldins jumps in front of... Oh, no, Fraz holds him off.
Yeah, Fraz sending it big time. You might be able to hear the revs up on the
limiter.
Okay,
good job. Take it home.
And that's, again, Graham Quinn on the radio to Tanner saying, good job, take it home. They know they've lost this race. It doesn't matter. They're teeing themselves up to make the final by being on the front row in the next one.
So Scott Speed, a couple more turns for him, and he will be on the front row of the finals. Round 5, Nitro Rallycross. Timmy Hansen up front. Travis Pastrana, his best pavement finish, but with the introduction of 3 heats, that means even with that victory, he goes to second row. So a little bit of a bittersweetness there as Scott Speed now finishes off and gets the checkered flag. Speed will be up front with Timmy Hansen. Pastrana will be in that second row. Thank you. But you know what? Regardless, he's in the final.
Jared, 3 heat races and our 3 championship contenders have gone through. So this is on for later on today. Do not miss the final.
No.
We're going to be giving away the first ever Nitro Rallycross Series title to one of the 3 who just won those 3 races. So, yeah, it's going to be wild.
This is how it all started. Liam Doran, the British bomb, gets up on the backside and blows everybody up. It looks like he might have punched Tanner's bodywork into his tire. And then, I mean, just all over.
That was the contact, look, and he felt either something broke in the car, or he felt he didn't have enough momentum to clear the gap at that point. So that's the way it goes with the contact in the second corner.
Yeah, look at the smoke coming off. And again, car didn't seem compromised power-wise. I think it was just, you know, the aero rubbing on the tire.
Yeah, definitely. It'll be the contact in the first corners. Just, you know, folded a bumper underneath or a fender underneath, and then that just rubs. And it can rub through the tire in the end, but luckily rallycross races are pretty short, so no problem for Faust, and he'll be front row next time. Look at the blue groove that's coming in, Jared, on the clay as well. It's nice to see it on the up-ramp on the jump particularly. Not so much in these left-handers. They've been watered a bit more. I love that section of track with the flick left-right.
Travis talked about moving in some different dirt to this track, and I think it really showed up. That was kind of the element that it just hasn't been a point of concern, you know, which is really great, you know. And Scott just ran away with it. It was all Scott's speed from start to finish. And this is what we expected. But like anything, you never know until the fat guy sings, aka this fat guy.
Incidentally, I think Subaru getting both of the cars through to the final will secure them the team's championship. I don't think now there's any risk of them losing that. But they've now got to have some serious discussions about what the plan is, you know, with Scott and with Travis and with Timmy. You know, Travis needs to be, if Scott wins, Travis has to be right behind him. Otherwise, the title goes the other way. And Timmy Hansen is the thorn in Travis's side. If he's between them, the title can go to Scott.
Yeah, all the different scenarios here. So Scott Speed, Tanner Faust, Fraser McConnell, Ronald Valdens, and Liam Dorn. That's how it ended up here on Heat Race 3. We'll continue on here at Nitro Rallycross, round 5 of supercars, but doubleheader action for Nitro Rallycross next. We had a winner yesterday, Sage Karen. When we come back, more Nitro Rallycross from the firm. Jared D'Enda here, Andrew Coley, your tour guides here. Pastrana getting it done, but Timmy Hansen and Scott Speed do as well. When we come back, more Nitro Rallycross from the firm here in North Florida.
The whole freaking week, we got it done, boys.
In 2018, Nitro Rallycross took the racing world by storm with the biggest jumps, the best drivers, and the most intense action ever. In 2021, Nitro Rallycross is expanding with 5 epic races. From the mountains to the Great Lakes, the desert, and the Sunshine State, Nitro Rallycross is coming to a racetrack near you. Nitro Rallycross, the series, revving up and taking off this September.
Nitro, short for nitroglycerin, or an explosive yellow liquid made by nitrating glycerol used in dynamite. So when things go nitro, they really go. Like this guy.
Everybody screams, everybody screams. That's my only thing, yes. I'm a born winner, a Jordan 23. All my PBGs until the party ceases.
Or you guys.
Run it.
And now racing's going nitro. So watch out, because nitro isn't just the fuel, it's a state of mind.
Run it.
Nitro RX is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Go to ZipRecruiter.com and put ZipRecruiter to work for you. O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices, every day. And by our partners at The Real Cost. Smoking as a teen can stunt your lungs, keeping them little forever. Little.
great big world.
With me, Tony Hawk.
My little lungs are starting to fail.
Smoking with a team can stop your lungs, keeping them little forever.
Tough break, little lungs.
In a great big world.
Welcome back, everybody, to Nitro Rallycross, where heat racing for the supercars has just gotten wrapped. Scott Speed, best possible position you could be in. You got yourself a pole in that final. How happy are you with not only your own performance, but Travis did great out there, too?
Honestly, like, I'm so pumped for Travis. I watched Travis's race from here, and, like, that's a tough task. And I'm so proud of him with that performance because, like, that was a drive his life. I mean, this is a track and a style that he doesn't have a lot of experience at, and he's killed it all weekend. Like, I'm super proud of him. So the fact that we're sitting, I think I'm first, and he's going to be right behind me in the final, if I'm not mistaken. So, man, that gives us as Subaru a team a great shot in the final to bring this championship home to Subaru, and couldn't be more happy for all these guys. Like, everybody has worked so hard and so well as a team. You know, we need to deliver them the result they deserve.
Thanks so much, Scott. Congratulations. And, guys, have you ever seen so much team spirit as we have going on right here at Subaru today?
Yeah, it's just absolutely infectious just seeing the Subarus, and again, just the camaraderie that word just keeps getting thrown around here, but absolutely spot on. So we're up here in the booth. Who's this guy? What are you doing up here? Shouldn't you be racing?
Yeah, I should be racing.
Or but, crashing?
No, I've only did that once.
Oh, man. Well, I got to bring up old stuff, right? Bilko, Blake Williams, thank you so much. And, dude, you having fun. Like we said before you came on camera, either crash out, DNF, or win the race.
Yeah, two DNFs, the DNF, and two firsts today. So I'm either first or last, Ricky Bobby style.
what do you make of the course here and the side-by-side racing, the whole field and everything?
Oh, there it is, right? There. Yeah, a little bit tip over. I mean, I'm a two-wheel guy, dirt bike and stuff, so I figured I'd get it on two wheels for a bit, but didn't quite bring it back down. And then there's the Australian flag got broken off. I was a bit disappointed about that.
But, yeah,
you know, the track's really good. It's just really difficult to pass. It's quite one line. It's missing a lot of the undulation and the hills and the bank corners, so you don't really have the option to go outside, inside, and keep the same momentum as the inside racing line. So it's pretty difficult out there. So yeah, you got to try and make it happen when you can, but if it doesn't work, you can always celebrate like that.
Well, I was going to say victory dance yesterday. I think the crowd enjoyed that. It was a good race, actually. Michaela was quick, wasn't she?
Yeah, definitely fast. That was, you know, I was pushing really hard to catch up to the back of her, and then she started going pretty defensive in the last couple of laps and dropped off the leader. And yeah, I just thought, you know what, I've caught all this way up from almost the back of the pack, so if I don't throw it in now, I won't be awesome. Happy with myself. So went in there, sent it, didn't pay off, but, you know, I had fun.
That's what it's all about, so thank you so much. Now let's throw it over to Nitro Rallycross next, semifinal. Now we're looking for four laps, and here's our racers. Casper Janssen, Lan Vakala, Martin Enlund, George McGinnis, Kyle Schwartz, and bringing up the back row there, Eric Gordon is joining Kyle Schwartz. The 32nd tire Yokohama card is up. And we are ready to send it here. Now, semifinal, what's at stake here, Coley, as far as, because all the racers are going to be in it, it's all about position.
It is about grid position. And at the minute, on the inside, on the front row, Casper Janssen leads the championship by only 10 points after what happened yesterday. His main rival, Sage Karaman, as one of his main rivals, has gone through. But he's got to watch out behind as well for Enlund and McGinnis. They need to get past Vakala in terms of pace. Brilliant start by Janssen. Then he had to kick the cuts. Maybe drops back just a little bit. McGinnis going out wide, trying the wide, tight line. Going to get up the inside of Enlund. Great move by George McGinnis. Manages to pass two cars to go up from P4 into P2.
Plenty of biff and barge there. These guys have been racing really hard. It's been awesome action in the lights class for sure.
And McGinnis does hold on. Bit of contact with him and Enlund. I don't know why Enlund was grumpy there. We didn't really see any
car. Oh, we got a roar.
Oh, yeah,
we have a car on the roof.
Eric Gordon's gone over in the gap jump underneath. Lan Vakala trying to get past, but he's caught up on the dirt berm. There is Eric. He's back on his wheels. Car looks okay, but if it stays there...
No, he's about to move, so I'm not sure if they'll pull the red flag just yet. I think he's going to get going. Give him a round of applause.
Yeah, let's go. Go on. So Eric Gordon pulls the car off. The crowd are going mad for that, and that's the gentlemanly thing to do. Gets it out of the way of everybody else. Is he going to try and carry on? No, he's going to park it.
Seems like a gentle tip over, so he's probably all right in there, but nice work to get off the track to let the racing continue.
So back out front, Janssen leading McGinnis by just 0.4 of a second. McGinnis's move. What did you think of that in turn one, Bill Coates?
That was
mega.
Awesome. He came out wide and cut up the inside while the other two were battling on the outside, and he was in perfect position for the third corner, and there he is now in second and putting a lot of pressure on Janssen right now.
So format-wise, we have four laps, and the top two advance on and then they'll move on to the finals.
There's only 25 points in it, Jared. So the minute McGuinness is 25 points back from Casper Janssen. Janssen, the championship leader, McGuinness in P4. Between them, Enlund and Sage Karam. Of course, Karam's gone through already. Martin Enlund is in this race too. So it's about grid position, but with just the one race to come later on, what row you're on is going to make a big difference.
Yeah, start's really key here, and even the second starting position isn't that good because you are on the outside, and you see then the driver got forced to the outside, and McGuinness snuck it up the inside, I think, from the second row. So that was a great move. But, I mean, it's amazing to watch these guys drive and how close they go to the barriers. They are pushing those next cars to the limit.
You've tried one of these cars, haven't you?
Yeah, I raced back in 2015, 2016. Unfortunately, the tracks weren't as racy as this and as long, so it was still a lot of fun, but these guys are really impressive to watch. They're so precise and so fast every lap, and it just shows how much talent these guys have.
Yeah, saw you on Barbados. That was a round that we saw you at.
Yeah, that was the first one I ever did. That was pretty damn fun. Should jump straight in the car and no helmet fan was probably the worst thing.
Oh yeah. Well, just FYI, Eric Gordon is okay. Race ops spoke with him and he is fine. So that's great. So he just sits stranded out there. But Casper Janssen out front. You can see everybody has taken that Joker lap, and it looks like Casper Janssen splitting. McGuinness, I'll tell you what, like I said, McGuinness was one to watch from round one, and just he's just gotten more and more calloused and getting more seat time. He is a fierce contender.
I'd keep your eyes on Enlund right now. He's closing the gap on McGuinness, and he is looking strong. I was watching him yesterday. He was driving at about 110% in that, I think it was the semifinal yesterday, trying to catch Janssen. And
yeah.
That was impressive. I think he overdrove it right on the last lap a bit. But for those three laps before, man, he was brushing barrels, just had the thing on the limit for the whole race.
He had such a great start to the season. He had three P2s and a win within the first four rounds and led the standings. And he's just had a little bit of a dip up at Wild Horse and the first of the Glen Helens. He was back on the podium at Glen Helen 2, round 8, and he's still in with a shout at the title. But later on, live maths is going to be appalling in this one. We're going to have four people, and we can't manage.
There's probably not too many people in this paddock apart from the engineers that are good at mathematics.
Yes,
I wouldn't ask any of the drivers.
And the white flag is out with Casper Janssen leading the pack. McGuinness second. Enlund, look at that. As you said, Bilko and Coley. Enlund right there. Don't overdrive it. And I think he could get a pass on McGuinness.
There's quite a large bump forming right there and into the entry of the corner. See, oh, he's going for up the inside. That was amazing.
Oh,
bit
wow,
of bump and grind, but he was well and truly up there. He set that up coming out of turn two, ran it really wide and slid it right up there beautifully.
Really good move, wasn't it? I watched the drivers pitch it in. They've been really rotating the car hard on the way into that right hand of the first dirt corner after turn two. And he judged that absolutely bang on. I didn't even think McGuinness saw him coming.
And it looks like Schwartz he's going to be a DNF as well, as Vakela finds his way through the split in the gap. But Enlund takes that spot from McGuinness. McGuinness is going to try to regain some ground. This is all about position on that starting grid for our finals. There is no LCQ. Everybody advances all eight vehicles as long as they make it to that starting grid.
Enlund's really sending it, isn't he?
He's
really, really pushing very hard.
Just like yesterday. So, yeah, he drives on the edge, and he's damn fast. But, Janssen's really held it together in this one. Got out front, kept it clean, and here he's going to come through for the victory.
He is indeed. Casper Janssen, the championship leader, goes through to row two of the final. Enlund, who sits second in the standings, is there as well.
Yep.
Sage Karam has already gone through to the front row, so it is absolutely on for an NRX next later on today as well.
I love it. Just the talent here and just about momentum racing. That's what we keep talking about. 300 horsepower all-wheel drive compared to 600 horsepower all-wheel drive. Just, you know, you really got to choose your line. Where's Enlund finding that power? What do you think? Like, it's just... It's race line.
I think he's tipped it in and he's on the power before he's even at the corner. So, but if you overdrive that tiny bit and you know, get offline, these cars will bog down quite a lot. Let's check out the replay. What happened in the background? I think it was
right there.
Enlund, yeah.
Look at the flip.
Just kind of got pinched off and hit the backside of the takeoff there. It's quite skinny through there for two cars. So I'm not sure if Enlund seen him there. And yeah, that ended a bit upside down. But here we see it again, I think.
Yeah, it was just a perfect storm. Unfortunately, Enlund flicking it in.
I feel sorry for Eric Gordon. That car was brand new and it's his first season in it. And he said to me that I'm still learning, you know, and it was mint. It came off the boat brand new out of the container. And right in the last round, Jared, he's done 10 rounds and he gets a roll. So I really hope we'll see Eric out in the final later on today.
They come with a 2-year warranty, right?
Yeah. I don't think it doesn't include rolling it, I think.
No. And there is Janssen. Just being real dominant from the start. And that's, you know, this is kind of alluding to, I mean, it's four cars, but we see how much calamity and how tumultuous it is. You know, we're gonna see, you know, we're starting supercars, 15 cars, whittling down to 8 total, correct? Or how many is it in the finals we're looking
is
at?
Is that a mass problem
in
again?
10 cars. What's that?
Is the mass problems coming out?
Exactly.
Again.
So 10 cars total in that final. So, but there's Kasper Janssen getting the victory. Martin Hedlund, he is one to watch. McGuinness got past there with one lap left to go. Lane Vaquela, and unfortunately a DNF for Kyle Schwartz and Eric Gordon, where the rubber did not meet the road.
It's crazy to see the different driving styles and which track they suit. You know, Travis, obviously, the first three rounds with all the jumps and the bank corners, he was on it. And then Scott Speed today is really on point as well. Yeah. But, you know, they're still pretty damn close up there. It's going to be a damn good final. Yeah. And there's a lot on the line, so no one's going to hold back.
Yeah, no one's holding back. And there's some drivers that never surrender. And those are drivers that might not have found themselves on the podium, might have had some bad luck, but they never surrendered. So I want to throw it down to Will, who caught up with the drivers who received the award. That is the Yokohama Tire Never Surrender Award. Will?
Yokohama have outdone themselves with these incredible awards that they are giving here to Kappa Bigham in the supercars class and Martin Hedlund for NRX next. I'm going to start with you, Kappa. Wow, what an incredible piece of wall art to have there. It symbolizes, though, what's been a very challenging season for you. I mean, when you look at it now, all the attrition that's happened for you and your team, I mean, put it in a nutshell for us.
We definitely had our ups and downs this year, and starting off with a relatively large wreck in Utah and an even bigger wreck in Minnesota, it was important for us to just completely reset and give the maximum effort going into each weekend. The team did a fantastic job. I feel like I did my part, and we ended up with a P5 in Arizona. And it's, like you said, it's been rough, but I'm very honored to receive this award.
You really have dug deep more than anybody in this award says that. Having this beautiful award here just take the edge off a little bit for you.
Yes, it does. It does. I think it's a bit expensive, you know, in the crash damage sense, but it's very nice to receive something like this, especially from Yokohama.
Well done, Kevin. Thank you very much. And Martin, for you, I mean, we've got to describe this as a roller coaster of a season, but there's been some great points in there. So on reflection, you know, when you look back, are you proud of what you've done?
I'm super proud to have been here with our own team, so super, super stoked to be here in the U.S. to race and to come home with some wins and so on. Even if the season has been a roller coaster, I'm super happy to have been done this series.
We're happy to have you here. Congratulations to the both of you. I'm glad you get these to hang on the wall to show what you've overcome this season. It's been absolutely fantastic.
From the mind of action sports icon, Travis Pastrana.
I mean, this is the only course in the world where cars literally fly.
Comes the next evolution in motorsports.
Almost landed on Hansen.
This is our Super Bowl. This is our Daytona 500, our Stanley Cup playoff game.
Spectacular purpose-built courses.
Decided to build one of the wildest tracks ever.
Incredible locations, from the desert to the snow. Huge jumps.
Wow, it's like they're launching out of a machine gun.
And drama at every turn.
This is literally the best, the wildest rallycross in the existence of the history of rallycross.
Welcome to Nitro Rallycross.
In 2018, Nitro Rallycross took the racing world by storm with the biggest jumps, the best drivers, and the most intense action ever. In 2021, Nitro Rallycross is expanding with 5 epic races. From the mountains to the Great Lakes, the desert, and the Sunshine State, Nitro Rallycross is coming to a racetrack near you. Nitro Rallycross, the series, revving up and taking off this September.
So we got Chase Elliott here, and when I came to you at NASCAR, you said, hey, I'll come race if you jump out of a plane that'll fly. What do you think about Nitro Rallycross? You ever see it?
I have seen it, and I want in. So
you want in?
I want in.
And I got him saying that right here.
100%, I want in. I'm down to do that if I can talk you into jumping out of an airplane.
You don't have to talk me out of, sounds great. That's great. I mean, look, we're at the track. Chase didn't crash the airplane. Well, yet he's still coming down, but this is awesome, man. We need a mega day today, and this is a great way to start it.
All right, so we're here with Robbie Madison, and as usual at Nitro Rallycross, there's always more going on than just the racing. We had a little bit of a stunt this morning, and Robbie, it didn't quite go the way you anticipated, did it?
Yeah, Travis and Chase Elliott had to scrap a bet that if Chase raced, Travis would jump out of a plane that he was flying. So we did that. I got lucky enough to go along with him. When we came together, I head down and caught Travis under free fall, and then we kind of grabbed hands. As we pulled away, he was on top of me, and I didn't want to pull my chute while they were above me, and I kind of waited a little bit too long. So when I pulled my chute, my emergency chute came out with it. I had two canopies open, which is a potentially catastrophic situation. I managed to land it sweet, but wild start to the day, that's for sure.
Now, were you below the altitude for the AAD to fire, or was it just a mishap?
I think I was below. I guess I can set them to different altitudes. I think my personal rig at home is set a little bit lower, so I just got caught out. It's your learning curve, I guess, you know. So I'm not the most experienced skydiver. I got like 270 jumps, but that's the first time that's ever happened to me. I'm just stoked I remained cool, and I got back here and got in the car and put her on the pole.
Well, explain to the audience real quick what it's like to have two chutes out, because it doesn't sound like that bad of a problem to have two chutes, but it's really hard to steer and get where you're going, right?
Yeah, two chutes out, it's all good if you can separate them and they don't like get entangled. If they get entangled to each other, they're your only two chutes that you got. So if they twist up, you're done. And I saw them open, I stayed cool, I got them separated. Essentially, you're meant to chop it, but I couldn't get them separated far enough, so I just rode them both in. Right before I landed, I flared my main canopy and landed sweet, so... It was a wild ride. I managed to stay cool, though, and that's what you got to do.
You're always cool under pressure. Glad nothing happened. You're still here with us, and as usual, it's a crazy day here at Nitro Rallycross.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Glad that Matto is here joining us. As got a little precarious there, but a gentleman that jumped out of a plane earlier, lived to tell about it, and also is finding himself in the finals. Unfortunately, second row, but still he's in the finals. Some great racing by Mr. 199. Travis Pastrana joining us up here watching semifinal. You could be down there, but you're up here talking with us. That's a great place to be.
Nah, this is great. I've been fourth quickest all weekend, and I tell you, Kevin Hansen raced me super clean in that first turn. I have nothing but so much respect and admiration for the Hansons. Appreciate those guys coming over here, adding so much to the series. And, dude, I didn't think I had it, but we put in a perfect run. Scott's actually been helping me all the way until now. I think the gloves are probably off at this point, but I just awesome. Super pumped. Subaru, I think, just wrapped up the manufacturer championship with both of us making the final. So I couldn't be more happy for Subaru and just all the things they've done for the sport of rally and for Rallycross here. Thank you guys for coming out. This is just absolutely amazing for me. So stoked to be in this position.
It's so good. And I feel like Scott's a proud father, but like you grow up and you want to beat your father, right? So that's where it's at right now. As take a look at our semifinal race one, you got front row, Kevin Hansen and Tanner Faust. Second row, Kevin Erickson, Robin Larson. And then finally, Ronalds, Baldens, and Cabot Bigham. We have how many laps we're looking at? We're looking at four laps, and we're only taking two racers. Remember, we start with 15. We narrow it down to 10. So there's five racers that are going to be watching from the sidelines. This is very critical.
Very critical. Larson has been on fire all week. He didn't have the best heat race there, but I tell you what, he's super quick. You saw Tanner Faust battling with Chase Elliott yesterday. This is going to be a great start. Here we go.
Here we go. Then Kevin Hansen on the inside will want to be there to help Timmy in his hopes if he can. Tanner Faust will have something to say about that. Great start by Tanner Faust.
inside.
From an even one on the inside, though, trying to go around the outside line. Now Robbie Larson right to behind Tanner Faust. Oh, Larson sideways somehow holds on.
Tanner's still going straight. I could not believe he didn't drop in right there.
Over the gap jump there, Robbie Larson and Kevin Hansen almost backed out, but they just had enough space to clear him. But Larson
side by side, I did not think he could go side by side. We saw Liam Doran not make it in the last heat, but they decided to go for it. This is going to be a battle.
That was really clean. I was surprised on how they were in uniform going to that first turn and the second turn. Then Robin Larson turns in and gets in the side of Erickson, or he gets in the side of Larson. But that was some pretty, that was the cleanest start I think we've seen so far with this many cars.
Wow, well, Tanner Faust had a good run. If his spotter was yelling clear, I was surprised that he went straight. The Joker on the first lap is a little bit slicker than any other lap because it is watered. You lose a little bit of time there.
Yeah, we actually, saw you. Yeah. I felt you were, there was more rotation on the car, and it was a little bit deeper than you were like. That was the water on the clay, was it?
Yeah, and then after that first time you go through, it just gets better and better. So the longer you wait through the Joker, the better. But then in the merge, if you do the Joker first, you can come and you can make about a half second. So it's a toss-up, really.
Faust 5.9 back. He's lost 4/10 into Kevin Hansen. There's not enough at the minute. I wouldn't expect Kevin to go this lap. You need 6.2 if you want it to be really tidy. And Kevin jumps on the anchors. He's going to go standard lap with Larson as Bowden blasts off in the background into the Joker. But this is about the gap between Faust and Kevin Hansen. It's 6.3.
Faust running it in super hard. He goes really wide there. Kevin actually doing a great job. That Honda's a little bit bigger of a car. He's not quite as on pace as he's been with the other ones, but he is still firing away today.
I'm really surprised coming off of that jump and taking that hard left, getting that car to rotate. We haven't seen anybody get into each other there. Do you think that's going to happen when we get 10 cars out there?
It's definitely going to happen, but if you look at this right here, we got a great battle. Kevin giving Tanner all he can handle. Tanner, you see him getting wide there. That just cost him any chance he had of beating Kevin, unless Kevin has some trouble there with Larson.
He's got to keep his eye on Larson, hasn't he? With Larson not having Joker yet, the gap there is at least close enough. So Faust, if he can get past Larson, will go through with Kevin. He'd like to go through and be a row up in front. We're hearing a lot from his spotter, Travis. Talk us through that relationship with you. I was saying to Jared earlier, it's emotional management, a bit like your relationship with Rianne and Gelsomino in the rally car.
The spotter's the most important for the Joker, as well as that first lap. If his spotter said, clear down, he could have come down in front of Timmy and made Kevin, and made this a totally different race right now.
And speaking of spotter, we're actually hearing from Tanner Faust's spotter. Let's listen in.
Oh, he got pushed way wide. Look at Kevin. He's doing awesome, man. This is the best that he's been running the whole time.
Erickson then is on for taking.
Oh, side by side over the jump.
On board now with Tanner Faust looking forward to Kevin Erickson. We need to get him back for P3, says Graham Quinn, and that's because only the top two go through. So he's pushing Tanner now. You've got to get him back again. Look how sideways Faust is. He's absolutely on a mission, but he's dropped time. Tidy up, Tanner. We've got to get him back.
But not only does he have to get him back, but he can't lose time getting him back. This is like I said, Larson's been on fire all week. Kevin has been absolutely amazing as well. These two have to work together as well as trying to overtake one another.
I have a puncture from where he hit me on the jump.
Okay, copy that. See if you can bring it home.
So there's a puncture there for Faust. They're just saying bring it home. He'll have to decide whether he's got enough to clear the gap. Watch now for Larson versus Kevin Erickson. Because of the battle, it may not be quite close enough. So it may be that Larson can hold on. They're on the final lap. Here we go then. Into the Joker, Kevin Hansen and Robin Larson. Into turn one goes Kevin Erickson. Watch from the right-hand side. Where's Erickson? I don't think he's going to be close enough. Definitely not for Kevin Hansen. He might be close to Larson now. Crowder on their feet as Erickson jumps over the gap, but Larson just holds on.
And remember, the normal lap take overpowers the Joker, so the Joker has to give way, but Larson did a great job there, and it looks like he holds on to that second spot. You can see the split there. Hansen, Larson, Erickson, and Faust.
So Kevin Hansen going to go through to the final. He'll be able to help Timmy out. There won't be anything untoward, but he'll want to put cars in between Travis and Scott and Timmy and try and get that long shot of Timmy trying to take the title. I'm sure Travis will have something to say about that, and so will Scott. But Kevin doing the job for the team. Larson and Erickson there. Puncture for Faust to put him out of contention. He's going to have to go to the last chance qualifier, but Kevin Hansen's going to go through. What does that mean for you, Travis?
Well, Kevin's been second quickest really all week. So this is great to see him go through, and it's two Hansens on the outside, two Subarus on the inside for the final. It's going to be just a bar burner.
Okay, checkered flag.
There's the checkered flag. Kevin Hansen gets the victory, and again, our top two drivers, Hansen and Larson, they advance, and it will take one from the LCQ of each heat, and then so that means eight drivers will be in the final. So quite a few broken hearts, seven drivers sitting to the side watching the eight compete. in that supercar final. But Hansen and Larson notably advance on. Erickson, Faust, Baldens, and Bigham are forced to the LCQ. Here's how it started.
Have a look for Larson, because he gets fully sideways here. Look, he turns in across Kevin Erickson and then gets the car rotating really nice in here. It looked like would either of them back off, but they both decide they can gum it. Looks like you only actually need about half that run-up, Travis, to get the clearance speed. But in your head, it's a short run-up.
It is a short run-up. These cars are 0 to 60 miles an hour in under 2 seconds. And at the end of the day, you only have to go 65 to make the jump. So
It's enough.
But having said that, you saw Kevin right there jump a little bit further. I think Larson had it if his spotter, you know, if he just charged that corner a little harder. This track is difficult to make a pass, so you have to take advantage of those. I think the spotter for Tanner Faust, if he would have told him to come down, that could have been a completely different race for Tanner as well.
And this is that final joker merge as Larson just edges out Erickson and holds on to that number two spot. Erickson, a great effort for him, but you talk about that big chassis there, Travis, and just rotating. Larson put it together even after the contacts. That was really well done, but that final battle here for second place, Erickson and Larson giving it a go.
That was the best I've seen Erickson do, and I think the track's really kind of moving. It's coming in where the bigger cars are starting to get more drive off of the corners. Look at this final. Bumps him across close. The finish line.
Yeah, really close, wasn't he, at the end there? I think it was Faust, wasn't it, who had the puncture, was just in front and probably backed it off. I mean, neither of them was going to go through. And it looked like either of them might go through earlier on in the race, and that's just the, you know, the ebb and flow of it. But there's your result in the top two through.
Hansen and Larson advance on into the finals. Erickson, Faust, Baldens, and Bigham are forced to the LCQ, the last chance qualifier. All right, so talking about the variety of drivers, again, we have that ZipRecruiter vehicle, Go Nitro car powered by ZipRecruiter. We've seen different drivers from Backroot, Kyle Busch, and notably this event, Chase Elliott will caught up with the 2020 NASCAR champion.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, Jared. And down here with Chase now. Chase, it's hard to describe the atmosphere right now under the Subaru tent. You're no stranger to championship day. These guys are here to duke it out today, really. So what's the energy like? Just talk to me about it.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like it's been pretty laid back, all things considered, and Travis and Scott are, you know, good friends. So, I mean, it's not like they're at each other's throats over here, but it's been a lot of fun. I'm the guy in the middle, so I guess I'm trying to separate them today. So, yeah, just been a lot of fun, and this is a great group of guys, and they've been just super helpful with me. And, you know, even in the midst of their championship battle, they're lending a hand and watching overlay videos and seeing things that I'm doing. So super gracious with their time, and I obviously really appreciate that because I need the help. So it's been great. So excited to see who pulls it out today, and then obviously on my end, you know, trying to get into the show and hopefully you know, have a front row view to watch it live in person.
And to be able to help them out a little bit too. And for you, what's it like to kind of get to be involved in this? It's a big day, obviously, for both of those guys, but you don't have to worry about the pressure. Is that kind of fun?
Yeah, super fun. I mean, I've been there, so it's you know, definitely a different vibe. And this is, you know, fun for me, but also at the same time, I've really enjoyed working with all these guys. You know, I would love to do more of this and get kind of a little more up to speed. I feel like I've come a long way in my couple days here, but certainly still have a long ways to go. So like I was saying yesterday, this track I think is really a good place for me to start because it does have a lot of asphalt. It does have some dirt too, but I think it's a good transition for a guy with my type of background. So it's been yeah, all smiles so far. Obviously the day's young, so it can go south in a hurry, but looking forward to whatever it brings.
We're glad that you're enjoying it. We really hope that you come back, Chase. Thanks ever so much.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it.
The Go Nitro car powered by ZipRecruiter, piloted by 2020 NASCAR champion Chase Elliott. Travis, not too shabby for, like you said, a couple days.
Nah, Chase is amazing. I mean, he doesn't have a lot of experience with all-wheel drive. He was scared to death of the jump and still sent everything. Always got a smile on his face. And, I mean, he put in an amazing battle with Tanner Faust. He's one of the best in rallycross all, you know, in the U.S. for sure.
Yeah, right now he's a contender for the Power Plus Power Move. We'll see if he holds on to that title.
Outside second row is going to be a tough place for him to start, but I tell you, he's been getting better and better. He's already quicker than me on most of the pavement sections on his like second day of driving, so that was a little disappointing for me, but pretty good for Chase Elliott, for sure.
In this semifinal race, too, Oliver Erickson, Steve Arpin, Fraser McConnell, Chase Elliott, Liam Doran, Oliver Bennett, Coley, send it.
Revs are up. Here we go. Booking slots in the final is on the cards here. Can Elliott do it from outside? Good start by Ericsson. Also by McConnell on the inside line. Very even. Arpin going to try and go around the outside. Chase Elliott gets around the outside of a two-wheeling Fraser McConnell. Who's going to go Joker first? That sideways contact. Elliott goes straight to the Joker.
Elliott goes Joker. Look, if these good guys position. Don't make the jump, that's a huge... We got one shut down.
Arpin shut down on the jump. Didn't feel he could make it. Chase Elliott went Joker straight away. Lost the start. Immediate decision. He's now in a battle with Fraser McConnell.
McConnell is an amazing driver, but if Elliott can pull this together, he might be able to win the semi. This
that
is amazing.
Would be epic. That would be absolutely epic. So again, Steve Arpin shuts it down. We haven't seen that come into play much this year as far as the run-up. Oh, look at that, Arpin.
This might be a red flag situation.
So yeah, Arpin's got the car beached on the side of the jump there. It is crucial in terms of jump speed that they can get over it. And we got a red flag. We have got a red flag. So I think that'll be a re-rack. I don't know whether they'll let Arpin re-rack or not, as he's the cause of the red flag. They might do. Yeah, there's no damage on the car. Did he just bail because we didn't have the pace to hit the jump, you think?
Yo, without a doubt, that was the good call. We talked about in the driver's meeting whether we skip the jump on the first lap, but the Joker gets pretty narrow. So every one of the drivers said, you know what, there's plenty of room to get the speed. The problem is when you're dicing and banging and someone's pushing you completely off the jump, there's just no room out there. So, we're going to make some improvements on the tracks in the future, and we know where not to put the jumps now, but this is definitely entertaining for the driver.
Look at how much blue groove is there, man. So there is some traction, but let's take a look back at what unfolded, what transpired here.
But look where the blue groove goes, straight from the inside to the outside. So if you're on the outside, like Arpin is right here, and he's got a lot of angle coming into this dirt, he's going to lose a lot of grip when he hits the dirt. So that's kind of a mistake that you make. You think it's going to continue at the same trajectory, and all of a sudden you go straight wide. So the inside's going out, the outside's going out, and you can see he's all the way to the edge. And the car on the inside, he's going to keep sliding too. So I think Arpin right here, when he got off the side, there was just no room, and he wasn't left any room, honestly.
Yeah, no, he was punched out. And if I'm Arpin, I definitely wouldn't have risked it right there. I mean, you could go right into the
other
side.
You would have gone. you got one shot at that. But no, I think Chase Elliott, that outside really came in. Chase had an amazing start. It's like a space shuttle launch. So to see, watch Chase go straight here.
Later.
And then you just lose so much traction going from pavement to dirt. And, you want to be ahead. It's a difficult track to pass on.
Good decision, I think, by Chase there, because that's the time, isn't it, Travis, where your spotter isn't necessarily telling you what to do. You have to react and make a decision for yourself.
Honestly, the NASCAR guys have been spot on. Kyle Busch is always in the right spot at the right time. All the guys on the ZipRecruiter car have actually done great, but that was a pretty good impact on the right rear to Arpin.
Yeah, you saw Arpin take the brunt of it, and rightfully so. Hansen got on the side of him, but Chase, with that position, he's definitely feeling it.
No, I would not be surprised. I'd be impressed, but not surprised if Chase was on the podium here at the end of this day.
And, wow.
The NASCAR guys are very undercredited as drivers. They're some of the best drivers they've ever seen. They adapt to everything. They have more seat time than anyone on the face of the earth. And they have to make – they only got two corners. Everyone's like, it's so simple. Yeah. But you have to make that half a tenth of a second a lap. So they're used to being absolutely perfect.
Yeah, and Chase was talking about, he's one of the best in road racing in NASCAR as well. So I think that adds to his credibility and his, ability to execute out here. So looks like they are re-racked, and you can see Liam Doran there pulling up in the rear. So Ericsson, Arpin, you see Fraz McConnell, Chase Elliott.
Yeah, we haven't heard a lot from Fraz this weekend. He had some car trouble basically that gives you timed laps that puts you the seed. He didn't quite make it ahead of Kevin, but Kevin's been super fast this whole weekend. So I'd like to see Fraz get a little bit more time. He's a really clean driver. He's just awesome. He's super fast. But it's difficult for someone that drives with as much respect as Fraz does out here, because you really have to kind of push around. But also with the officials not really allowing that, it's kind of a toss-up on what's going on and how you make a pass out there.
Well, now Fraser McConnell, he suffered some mechanical issues yesterday, from a trans bolts to flywheel bolts, and we saw him doing some testing out there in the airstrip.
Yeah, he was on the runway this morning, a bit like Travis was. Travis went to jump out of an aeroplane, as you do when you're preparing to win a championship, whereas Fraser was just shaking down an engine, which is perfectly sensible. But he was out. So engine change for McConnell. The car looked quick in the previous run in the heat race, but he's got to get it done this time. Right, so is anybody going to do something different in turn one than they did last time? Are we going to see any carnage or a nice clean start again?
Ericsson on the inside line. Oh, he balks! Just gets missed by the car behind. Sideways, Liam Doran.
Big
ground, big ground. A wheel off Liam Doran's car. Nothing he can do to avoid that. And it's Arpin who leads this time as Fraser McConnell dives up to the joke with Chase Elliott in right behind. Bennett also going up. And right at the back.
Liam has always been in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Oh, I know. It's gutting, isn't it? Absolutely gutting.
Terrible luck for the British bomb.
Travis, I think this could be another red flag.
That's a red flag.
Because where he's sitting, yeah, it is. He was too fast and too narrow. I've seen you coming through. There's a little bit of opposite lock coming onto the straight in like fourth, fifth gear. So they're going to have to clear it out.
This is amazing. There hasn't been really any carnage. And then we have this pretty narrow pavement first turn onto the dirt, onto the jump. Definitely noted for track designs in the future.
Another note.
But I feel like this is the most standard track that we've had. So everyone fights so hard because usually Nitro Rallycross, there's a lot of places where people can make mistakes, where you can make passes. Out here, you just have to be perfect, and it's really difficult. So everyone is taking every bit that they can in that first turn, especially through here. I mean, you know, Liam's an aggressive driver, and when you see a stall in the start, that just never happens.
That was just bad luck.
They did incredibly well to miss Ericsson. That's the other thing, is to collect him, Travis, with the speed, even from
you
the
20... You see Liam shaking his head. He's like, you got to be kidding me.
I know, yeah. And it's the second year of this for Liam. Like, he had a shocking year the year before as well, just with little car issues and stuff. This isn't a car issue. This is a crazy start. But I'm gutted for Liam, and he'll be back out, I'm sure, in the LCQ and desperate to make it through to the final. Here we go. There's another
look at
him. Watch Ericsson. He bobs. And yeah, Doran just clips him. He tried so hard, but from two rows back, Travis, he's probably two gears up by then already. These things are so fast.
He's 50 miles an hour at that point. And you go... Like, you don't realize how fast. On TV, it looks slow, and you're like, oh, I can make that jump. I'm like, the jump's 65 miles an hour out of a 90-degree right on dirt. Like, you're still flying.
Suddenly, didn't it? Normally you see a clutch kick and someone trying to get away, but it bombed.
That's a handbrake. I've done the same thing. It's a space shuttle launch on these things. It's, I get made fun of so much. I used to stall these cars all the time, and I still probably stall in the final, but not today. No, you drop the handbrake and the clutch at the same time, and if you're 0.02 late on the handbrake, the car stalls because the handbrake's still on when the clutch is off.
Yeah.
So I've actually been really, really impressed with how well Chase Elliott has done on these starts. And just the level, it sounds silly, but the level of intelligence and the comprehension of vehicles for all the NASCAR guys that we've had that have come in, that have looked into this stuff, it's been absolutely amazing. And Chase to come in, not only learning all-wheel drive, but learning all the starting procedures and everything, and doing it so calm and so methodically, it's been a pleasure watching him learn this stuff.
And you know, we're talking about Liam Doran, right, and his vehicle, but let's talk about Ollie Ericsson's car. His car took quite a hit. It might have sustained some damage as well, but, I mean, it's very interesting what happened. So
we're going to go with Ollie kind of caused both of these with giving a little push.
Hey, speaking of causing damage, this gentleman right here, three-wheel expert, hot dog, high-flying, Trevor Pastrana, one of your best friends. How would you describe this man right here?
Trevor, America. He is America. Look, three-wheelers, beer bonging, hydroplane skimming, two-stroke, oil burning redneck. But you know what's awesome? He's jack of all trades. He was out on the track crew at Glen Helen. He got second a couple weekends ago in the Pit Viper halftime show. He's always there to help.
And he's
why do we just have a full
Trevor Pastrana segment? Because he's down. He's a man of the people. He's out there mingling with everybody, crushing beers. And, you know, Tommy couldn't join us here this weekend, so we got Trevor Pastrana to fill in.
No, that's awesome. He's the hardest working guy on the Nitro crew. And, hardest partying too, hardest everything that you could imagine. But no, he's just the first guy here helping the track crew, helping all the guys set up everything. He's the first guy there on the dozers, on the equipment, on the water trucks. Shoot, when we had like two tornadoes pretty much coming through, the wind was so strong. He was out there watering from 4 o'clock in the morning, and he just always has a smile on his face. So definitely, if you see Trevor Pastrana, go up, give him a high five, and if you have a beer, maybe give him one of those too.
Yeah, are you excited about the Pit Viper happy hour? You got your Pit Vipers on, and you know, we've seen different iterations from the minivans in Minnesota. We saw the PT Cruisers.
I don't even know. Are we doing limos? What
Broncos.
Are we doing here?
What's Broncos, that? Apparently.
Broncos. Yeah,
well, like SUVs. They're like SUVs.
Jim York from Pit Viper wanted to do the limos here, and I thought there was going to be more sand. I'm like, you guys are going to high center and hold up our show. So it's good to see they went with the Broncos, a little bit bigger vehicles. Hopefully. I think there's going to be some tires flying off, just like we saw with Liam's car there. But that's what the show's all about, man. It's got to bring a little nitro to Nitro Rallycross for sure.
No, it's been fun. And I like the PT Cruisers. I mean, you saw our buddy Terry Madden air that thing out. And
Street Bike Tommy took credit for Terry Madden absolutely launching. We're like, it's not going to make it.
Yeah.
He went 100 feet in a PT Cruiser, and the thing disintegrated, oil all over the first turn of the track. He didn't care. It was great.
Speaking of oil being cleaned up, we're going to clean up the track. When we come back, we'll take a short break. We'll give you a little teaser of what the Pit Viper Happy Hour is all about. But it's going down here, but a different variety. So when we come back, more Nitro Rallycross from the firm here in North Florida.
All right, Trevor Pirana here. Now, most professional race teams like to operate out of the pits, but not this band of misfit delinquents. We're out here in the Boneyard where these guys are prepping and testing their cars. Now, this is as close to the general public as their parole officer allow them to get, and most of these guys don't even have an active driver's license between the three of them. And as you can see, they're here stripping any of the plastics and glass off these vehicles, anything that could possibly break or be left on the race surface themselves. And they are pure athletes to the full extent of the word. And coming up later today at 3:20, you're not going to want to miss this race. This is the main event. This is what everyone's here to see. Absolute carnage. None of these vehicles are meant to be on a race course, and you're going to see a lot of high rollover potential. Jim, how do you think the odds are out there today?
Oh, man, we got a tighter points race than any other race out here. And that points is just whoever rolls over first wins or loses. But everybody goes home, like, having a good time. So, yeah, going to be amazing.
Not as much of a race as it is a competition to just put the thing on the roof, huh?
I mean, we all don't want to, but we all know what's going to happen. So that's kind of it, yeah.
All right, well, that's what's to watch out for here in the Pit Viper Happy Hour.
In 2018, Nitro Rallycross took the racing world by storm with the biggest jumps, the best drivers, and the most intense action ever. In 2021, Nitro Rallycross is expanding with 5 epic races. From the mountains to the Great Lakes, the desert, and the Sunshine State, Nitro Rallycross is coming to a racetrack near you. Nitro Rallycross, the series, revving up and taking off this September.
Nitro, short for nitroglycerin, or an explosive yellow liquid made by nitrating glycerol used in dynamite. So when things go nitro, they really go. Like this guy.
Everybody screams, everybody screams. That's my only thing, yes. I'm a born winner, a Jordan 23. All my PBGs until the party ceases.
Or you guys.
Run it.
And now racing's going nitro. So watch out, because nitro isn't just the fuel, it's a state of mind.
Run it.
The 2021 Nitro Rallycross season has been one of the most exciting racing series of the year. With so many moving parts and epic and remote locations, you need people you can count on. Nitro Rallycross is built on a foundation of amazing people powering this series. From the teams to the operation crew, the TV production, timing and scoring,
the live experiences on site, the track crew, the drivers, and the team at Power Plus who keep us all going. Thanks for a successful 2021 Nitro Rallycross season. Power Plus. Power when you need it, where you need it.
Nitro RX is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Go to ZipRecruiter.com and put ZipRecruiter to work for you. Subaru. Love. It's what makes Subaru, Subaru. And by Yokohama Tire. Make every drive a performance.
Set the grid there to get this semi-final back out. I'm here with Liam Doran. Liam, another frustrating finish for an NRX race for you now. Just kind of talk us through what happened out there and how you're feeling.
Yeah, I'm trying to smile. I think that was probably the worst luck I've had all year. I messed up in the heat race. I really shouldn't have made that move in the heat race. I went too hard. I made my life hard work, went to the back of the grid. And I had the lap times in the heat race. I had really good lap times. I had good hopes of the semi. All right, I was on the back, but I had a really big plan of going smart and not touching anyone and just trying to use my lap times to get to the front. And then that happened. So there was nothing I could do, really. It's not Oliver's fault, of course. It happens. I was really lucky to get around the car, actually. I thought I was going to hit him square on in the back. So I was really lucky to get around, but I didn't quite get around enough and rip the wheel off the back of the car. So, yeah, seems to be wrapping it up nicely for me.
Thanks for smiling. Thanks for talking to us. And sorry that happened, Liam.
Yeah, you'd look bad if I didn't smile on TV, wouldn't it?
You did a great job.
Wow, just gutted for Liam, and he's had some tough breaks here this year, but always just a personality, you know, in the grid.
He's so honest, Jared. When he said, "I made my own life difficult with the decisions I made in the heat race," and then, you know, that's really honest. I didn't go my way in the heat race. He blamed himself for it straight away. He's a good guy, Liam.
Yeah.
Right, Chase Elliott. Yeah, he's keen now. Attempt number three. Here we go again.
Yeah, I mean, have we seen a red flag maybe this whole season? We just seen two. I think maybe one.
We've had a couple. I don't think we've red flagged the same race. I want to say we haven't red flagged the same race twice, which immediately means we'll get replies on social media saying, yes, you did, and you've forgotten.
Exactly. Here we go.
Let's get this done this time round. Ericsson on the front row won't stall this time. I'm sure of that. This time it's a good getaway. Arkin on the outside. McConnell has got a bit of space. Dives across the inside line. Bennett getting a little to the over-under on McConnell. Looking up the inside in the mini, but can't get there. Bit of smoke off the back of Ericsson's car as Arpin, Ericsson, and McConnell all go Joker on the first lap. And it's Chase Elliott's gone into the Joker with Bennett. Yes, a standard lap for the front three.
All right, so Ollie Bennett and Chase Elliott go through. But right now, it's all about Arpin. So Arpin, you know, he got a bit of a savior there. You know, he had that re-rack, you know, had the red flag. Liam there, and now it looks like, look at that.
Ericsson's really rotating the car early to try and find a way past on the exit. He does it again here. Look, smoke pouring off the rear left. That might be a consequence of the contact with Liam. Remember, they haven't had time do anything to that car. Arpin rides the curbs into the back section, kicks up a bit of dirt. Ericsson's all over him. They've got the one thing's gone their way, and that's that Chase Elliott is not in clear air. Oh, and he gets into the back of Arpin, really lets him know he's there. So Arpin's not getting the turn in that Ericsson's getting. It looks like Ericsson's got a quicker car underneath him, but he's got to get through, Jared.
Yeah, right now, so what's at stake here is four laps. The top two advance to the finals. So you just want to be in the top two. You can't win in semifinals. You got to get to the final first.
On board with Fraser McConnell. You can see the smoke is actually causing him difficulties. He goes wide. McConnell goes straight to the Joker. So McConnell trying to cover off Bennett and Elliott, who went Joker on the first lap. This is a good move by Fraz.
I was just going to say that.
Yeah, and he knows that the two out front are battling, Jared. So this could play into his hand, but he's got to get there in front of Bennett and from the commentary position.
Whoa.
Oh, spin. Hold on to it, Fraz. Light it up.
Oh, I don't know what. Gets back in line. So rules specify that basically the Joker lap needs to give way to the standard lap.
That's tricky, Jared, because, you know, it's all very well having that rule, but when in the heat of the moment, you know, Bennett's come down, they'll both say, I didn't have enough room, and the problem is where Fraz has gone off. Kasper Janssen did that yesterday, and they gave him a 5-second penalty for it, so he has gone track limits. I know it's not his fault, but he's gone track limits, and so they may take that away, but Arpin and Ericsson now look 10 seconds up the road, so the pair of them can go through, and their spotters may well tell them that. They'll still want to be a row up if they can.
Yeah, and you used the word salvation earlier. I think that was a case of Fraz just holding on to it, not spinning out, staying in it, and pinning to win it, as he did cut course, but it was only by default. It wasn't by design.
No, exactly. So they may let him get away with it, but unfortunately, it's not going to make any difference. Give him a penalty or not, what that'll do is put him back a row in the LCQ, which would suck for Fraz. And he comes in front now of Ericsson.
Robin Larson, Ollie Bennett went off the side of the jump, just crawled down, didn't go at speed, but he just exited stage left.
So Ollie Bennett's all right. Meanwhile, Luke, we've got an absolute ding-dong going on between Ericsson and McConnell in the OMSC Fiestas. Ericsson's got he's got the rear left tyres off. I wonder why he's gone back. They were 10 seconds up the road, Jared. He shouldn't have been at the merge with Fraz. He should have been clear in front. Look, there's the tyre off, and Chase Elliott's going to go through as well. He squeezes Chase. But Ollie can't hold on to that. He might as well give up the position.
Yeah, Ericsson, that back left does not have a tire
McConnell's,
on
McConnell's got a problem too, Jared. So McConnell was super sideways. Elliott has jokered, and he's going to get up into P2, is he?
I believe so. Chase Elliott moves up to, out of the woods, I believe he's still third.
He is. So he's obviously triggered the timing line just before Fraz. Steve Arpin in front of us has gone joker, and he's miles in front. He's irrelevant compared to these two. So Fraser McConnell in a battle with Chase Elliott. A question mark over Fraz's line earlier. Elliott goes wide, tight, trying to find a way past Fraz. He's right behind the Jamaican now. The NASCAR superstar looking to pass on a jump. He's in behind, and they come up over the standard lap. Great drive for Elliott.
Look at that. So Chase Elliott, he's going to try to surge in on Fraz McConnell. Oh, he throws it out way too wide. Scrubs some speed. Fraser McConnell, he's got all of Jamaica supporting, cheering him on. And, of course, you got that of Chase Elliott, all NASCAR Nation cheering for him.
I hope you can hear the crowd at home, because it's absolutely epic. They love a good race at Nitro, and this is a great one. McConnell desperately trying to hold on for Chase Elliott. Steve Arpin booked his space. Look, he's checked out. He's in a different postcode.
Yeah, look at this. Arpin, 10-second gap. But watch. Remember, yesterday, Chase Elliott got into the side of Tanner Faust. Is he going to execute it cleaner than he did yesterday? Here's an opportunity. Arpin, guess what? He's moving on to the finals, but the real race is for second place. Fraser McConnell and Chase Elliott, a newcomer, piloting that Go Nitro car, powered by ZipRecruiter. Can Chase Elliott do it? Here we go. He re-enters in, and no, he does not.
It was so
just a little too wide, and Fraser McConnell flying the Jamaican flag is in the finals. But hey,
so we are hearing potential penalties, so maybe not. But a great race between them. I wish we'd seen what happened. Chase was right there, wasn't he? He went for the other side, Jared. I thought he'd do what you said and go inside, and he ended up outside. Wild ride.
How did Ollie's car end up like the front end of it? I mean, dude. Ollie Bennett rips across the finish line. What is going on right now? This is the most insano heat ever.
Everyone has hashtag Go Nitro in this one. Like they've seen that promo and they're just like, I'm just going to send it. I'm going to light it.
Say no more, fam. I'm going to go Nitro. Yeah. Go ham. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. I mean, again, we were initially red flag. Arpin couldn't make the jump. Doran goes in the back of Ollie. I don't know how his front end got damaged. That back left puncture. Fraz McConnell, Chase Elliott going for it. The race definitely under review.
That's the understatement of the year, isn't it?
Right? Yeah.
Really? Oh,
zero chill, bro.
Huge surprise, yeah.
Relax. Oof. Doing it for the gram, bro.
See, the hood of Ollie Ericsson's car is right up. Look, that's what I mean about the crowd. I don't know if you guys can hear it at home, whether we hear it outside our cans here or whether we're hearing it through... through the show, and you guys will be able to hear them as well. They go absolutely mental for a good race, and that was a banger.
Let's back it up here.
That's where the hook came up.
So you see Ollie. That was like the first little love tap, making his presence felt, but it got even more damaged.
So Ollie at this point looked like he had more pace than Arpin, didn't he? And then for whatever reason, I thought he was going to be miles out in front. This is the merge between Bennett and McConnell. So Bennett's on the inside, and Fraz tried to find a way. I think he's hoping to bounce off that dirt, but it pinches him inside the apex in the next corner, and that is, for me, what's under review. There might be some other contact that's under review as well. I mean, there might be a list down there.
Yeah, they're running it off like a CVS receipt. So as you can see, going into the side there, bouncing off. And this is where Erickson and Chase Elliott, and then Chase Elliott made that pass.
The rear left's hanging off that car already. I think the wheel was moving around in the arch as well as the puncture. Then Fraz, for some reason, has this massive sideways moment, because he had 3 or 4 seconds on Chase Elliott at that point. Ah, now I know why. So the timing line is on the track. The reason it looked like Chase was in front is Fraz had gone around the outside of the timing line. So that's why it registered Chase had got past him. And then the NASCAR star, I say, look at this huge jump. Noses the ZipRecruiter Go Nitro car in and can't quite get past.
Yeah, and that got hairy there going into that jump. You saw Fraz kind of throw a block there. Look at him maxing out that angle. And Chase Elliott scrubbing a lot of speed there. And that's where Fraz got to pull away from him. But overall, just a really exciting battle between Chase Elliott and Fraz.
Fraz's rear right looks like it might be down to me at that point. I wonder if he was carrying a puncture too. You can see Elliott there on the handbrake, swinging the rear end of the car around. Hard to tell. He tried the round the outside. Maybe Fraz did have a puncture. But I mean, either way, epic race between the two of them. And now it's for the stewards to decide who goes through, which is a shame. But, you know,
hey, guess what? What could be really interesting here is if Fraz gets penalized, he would move back and Chase Elliott would move up.
Yeah. There is Chase Elliott with his spotter Joe Norton. Conversation over. They'll be waiting to see whether or not he's through.
And the final results are coming in as Fraz steps outside of his vehicle. We'll see. I mean, there's so many things going on during that heat. Remember, there was 4 laps. The top two advance on to the finals. And here are the final results.
Oh.
So Steve Arpin and Chase Elliott advance on. Chase Elliott is in the finals after Fraser McConnell is penalized. So Chase Elliott advances. Look at this. Let's throw it down to you, Will, who's with Chase.
I am indeed, Jared. Yeah, and Chase has literally just got the news right now that he's through. Yesterday, that did not go your way. Today, it did. So, I mean, interesting race from start to finish, but you made it through.
Yeah, that's all that matters. I don't really know the rules well enough to know why the guy in front of me got a penalty. But regardless, crazy race. I felt like the first start I thought went really good. Then the second one, I don't know if the clutch was hot. Or whatever was going on, but it was grabbing and kind of stalling. So my starts were terrible on the last couple. And then it was just kind of playing catch up. I feel like my last couple laps were pretty good. I saw a buddy in front of me had a flat. So I was trying to, I was trying to give him room. I kind of thought he might wreck there at some point. So I didn't want to pile into him, but obviously he needed the spot. But regardless, glad to be moving on. Excited for more laps and hope everybody here has enjoyed it. Great crowd. Thanks to everybody for coming out. This has been a great experience and excited to be a part of the show.
Thanks so much, Chase. We'll see you out there soon.
I mean, not the way you want to get it done, but as he says, you know, the rules, they kind of worked against them yesterday. They worked for them again today. But there was a big, gutted reaction from our Jamaican fans here cheering on Fraz because, you know, but we're talking about it up here in the booth. I think if Fraz kind of gave way to Ollie Bennett coming down off of that the normal lap, not coming out of the Joker lap, I think, I assume, we're going to talk to the stewards here and get clarification on exactly why he was penalized. But you can see Chase wrapping out with Dan Antil and then the Subaru team down there in that pit. So, yeah.
See, I think I'm looking at the front row of the LCQ, Jared. So the last chance qualifier, Kevin Erickson and Fraser McConnell, I think, are going to be on the front row. So they both run out of Wolfsburg's MSC, one in the Honda, one in the Ford Fiesta. And only one person, of course, is going to go through from the LCQ. And I think there's going to be 8 cars in it, assuming that we get everybody back out. So Bennett, we saw roll off the side of the jump. I think the car was okay. Liam was missing a wheel, so there's a bit of work for people to do. But there is one more chance to make it through to the main event later on today.
All right, so as we are seeing, again, we will be seeing the LCQ, and then the LCQ start list here is those are the remaining drivers who have one more shot. And remember, one race, one advances from each. So as you can see, Kevin Erickson, Fraser McConnell, Tanner Faust, Ollie Bennett, Oliver Erickson, Ronald Ballins, Liam Dorn, and Cabot Bigham. So again, we have 8 cars total, so we'll take one from each race. So when we come back, more Nitro Rallycross, the side-by-side final featuring a star-studded cast out here at the firm
Round five of Nitro Rallycross here at the firm in North Florida when we come back.
From the mind of action sports icon, Travis Pastrana.
I mean, this is the only course in the world where cars literally fly.
Comes the next evolution in motorsports.
Almost landed on Hansen.
This is our Super Bowl. This is our Daytona 500, our Stanley Cup playoff game.
Spectacular purpose-built courses.
Decided to build one of the wildest tracks ever.
Incredible locations, from the desert to the snow. Huge jumps.
Wow, it's like they're launching out of a machine gun.
And drama at every turn.
This is literally the best, the wildest rallycross in the existence of the history of rallycross.
Welcome to Nitro Rallycross.
In 2018, Nitro Rallycross took the racing world by storm with the biggest jumps, the best drivers, and the most intense action ever. In 2021, Nitro Rallycross is expanding with five epic races. From the mountains to the Great Lakes, the desert, and the Sunshine State, Nitro Rallycross is coming to a racetrack near you. Nitro Rallycross, the series, revving up and taking off this September.
Nitro RX is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Go to ZipRecruiter.com and put ZipRecruiter to work for you. O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices, every day. And by our partners at The Real Cost. Smoking as a teen can stunt your lungs, keeping them little forever.
Little lungs in a great big world.
With me, Tony Hawk.
My little lungs are starting to fail.
Smoking as a teen can stunt your lungs, keeping them little forever.
Tough break, little lungs.
In a great big world.
All right, we are getting set up for our side-by-side finals, and we have some notable names. We also have a special guest up here in the booth, Benito Guerra. Did I say that right?
Yeah, right. Thank you, Jared. Thank you very much. I'm really happy to be here with you guys. I'm starting to learn a lot from this Nitro Rallycross.
Yeah, Nitro Rallycross is a different breed, but you come from the stage rally world. You race WRC, and how's that been going? And can we see you out here someday?
Yeah, we are planning to do something here. I'm here with my sponsors and my managers for looking for the next year, maybe with electricals.
Ooh.
And I think it will be really nice to be here with all these amazing guys.
Yeah, that's right. Like it's just a different breed. Well, look at this star-studded cast. This is a special. We got Blake Bilko Williams. Robbie Madison, Corey Willis. We got Michaela Island Kudlinski. We got Scotty Lawrence, Haley Deegan in the building, Cody Martin, Hubert Rowland, everybody's favorite redneck, Tyler Vakela, who is related to Lane Vakela, and then Jordan Berza. So a star-studded cast there, 10 side-by-sides, so this should get very exciting. We had our own standalone event yesterday, and we'll have one again today. So who's going to come out on top? Coley, again, some notable names, and let's see if Bilko can keep the rubber where it meets the road today.
Yeah, he got a little roll yesterday when he got alongside Michaela Arlen-Kotlinski, who's on the right of your picture there. On your left is Corey Willis, who won yesterday. So they were P1 and P2, but they're on the second row this time. Good start on the front row for Madison and for Bilko. And around the outside, I think it might be Robbie Madison who's managed to get that done. So I think, yeah, it is Bilko with the Australian flag flying off the top there. So if you're not sure which one it is, it's that one.
Yeah, he knocked that Australian flag off. We got six total laps here for our final. Benito, have you ever raced side-by-sides?
Yeah, I used to be a Polaris driver, and I know what it's... I never competed with them, but I practice a lot with them because it's really similar to a rally car, and it's really fun to drive, but competing wheel-to-wheel, it's... maybe a little bit dangerous. If you touch, it's very easy to roll the car.
Yeah, we saw that yesterday. Again, open wheel compared to the next cars or, you know, the supercars. Obviously, they have a full chassis around them, and we saw that with Bilko. So hitting that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. So the inside is the Joker lap. You see quite a few drivers, including Bilko. You're seeing Michaela, Deegan, Martin, and Michaela, all of them hitting that Joker lap. But Bilko, wow, takes the lead.
Something happened there.
Michaela Arlen-Kotlinski is in P2 again, Jared, and the first time she's driven these side-by-sides, right up there. This is a reversal, of course, of yesterday when Bilko was right behind her and hassling her towards the end of the race. Hayley Deegan up into P3. Trying to see where yesterday's winner is, has jokered. So the joker, we think, is around, well, in next, it's around 2 to 4 seconds out the back there. Not sure if it might be similar in
Whoa, huge roll.
That's Bilko. The leader goes over and then he guns it and he's back on it already. So Bilko rolls the car, but that puts Michaela Arlen-Kotlinski into the lead from Hayley Deegan. Bilko goes off backwards. His side-by-side may well be done. But at the minute, it's Arlen-Kotlinski and Deegan out front.
Wow, absolutely insane. Bilko goes up and ends up on his roof, but then ends up... We talked about where the rubber meets the road, but unfortunately, I think the vehicle might be compromised.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
That's not ideal, is it?
No, something's broken. We thought it was a really quick recovery after roll the car. Something's broken.
So what are you thinking, mate, when you see this? You've said already you'd like to come and do this next year. I mean, it's different to rally, isn't it? Starting alongside other cars, I've been lucky enough to do a bit of both. There's a real buzz about it. It's a very different skill, racing other people. Have you done much racing in the past? Or?
Yeah, I start racing like in the racetracks, and it's really, really fun. But it has been like maybe 15 years. I have not raced with anybody in the track. So I think we should learn. And coming back again with a gravel experience as a stage rally, it will be not so difficult.
So Arlen-Kotlinski leading from Deegan. Still Robbie Madison is within reach. Maddo is 6.3 back. That's about right for the split for supercar. Oh, and we're seeing somebody diving on the outside there. Runs a little bit deep. But maybe only 2 to 4 seconds the difference up at the far end. We've been caught out a few times, Jared, by the track conditions changing up on the Joker and the standard lap as well for these guys.
Yeah, Michaela out front. Hayley Deegan, look at that. Female 1 and 2 with Lawrence in second, and Martin sitting in fourth with, as you said, Matto currently sitting in fifth. But 6 seconds, I don't know if that's enough, if he can make that up. We're halfway through this six-lap race.
Arlen-Kotlinski looks to have gapped Deegan just a little bit. Great showing from her. Oh, Hayley Deegan just runs the car deep, drops a couple of wheels out in the dirt on the outside. Travis posted a video of her yesterday getting fully sideways. She backed it in big time into turn one. It was a great bit of car control. I'm loving seeing the skills. NASCAR truck racing, I think, isn't she now, Hayley?
Yeah, she's doing NASCAR truck. She was voted, as far as the Camp World Truck Series, the favorite driver of the year. So some great success for her, and she has just been just racing and just making large strides in the racing world.
So she's dropped back into P3. It's yesterday's winner, Corey Willis, is up into P2 now. Maddo is at 6.6. That gap's not coming down. Jared has gone up by about 0.4.
Benito, you were talking about, you know, you raced WRC stage rally, but you're also, before we jumped on here, but you're talking about the electrification, the electric rallycross car. Have you driven an electric vehicle or an electric race car at all?
Not a race car, just a normal street car. But I think this is the future of all the motorsport, and we should start adapting to these new kind of vehicles. I think they will be really, really fast. This new one, it will become 0 to 60 in less than 1.5 wow. seconds. So it's really, really fast.
Yeah. The electrification, obviously all the manufacturers are taking strides in it. What do we got here, Coley?
Arlen-Kotlinski, just a little mistake on the brakes. Maybe not even a mistake. She just caught a bump and the rear of the car got really sideways. It's allowed Willis just to close the gap down a little bit, but still two laps to go. And now Willis runs a little bit deep and gets a wheel in the roost. So Arlen Kolinski pegging that gap at 1.8 at the minute, and I am really, really impressed with his drive.
Yeah, Michaela has, I mean, from yesterday even to today, you can just see when she gets that fresh air, she is out front. And, you know, it's not like she's just showing up because, as you say, she races in the Extreme E, more electrification for you.
Yeah, and another electric off-road series, which I'm lucky enough to announce. And I know people are a bit scared of electric, but, the racing will still be awesome. And when you've got 1,000 peak brake horsepower that we've got in the FC1X in Nitro, I'll live with it, you know. I don't mind.
No, not at all. All right,
look at the first gravel corner. It looks like it's like maybe a jump or a ditch.
Look at
and with these kind of vehicles, it's really difficult to handle the car when it's Belko saying hi.
Yeah, we've caught Benito. He's saying really difficult to handle
the
car.
Yeah, when you have a ditch, it's really easy to roll the car because the dampers are working like fully committed. And when you hit the ditch, it's really easy to get the car in two wheels.
Willis has got the gap down to 1.1. Now it goes up to 1.2. That's where Arlen Kolinski had a moment on the previous lap, and this time she uses that bump to help rotate the car. Really nicely done. Just one lap to go when they reach the start-finish line this time round.
Matto's still got to take that Joker lap. I don't think there's enough time, though. 7.4 seconds, that's a lot.
I think it's a lot. I was here, I spoke to a couple of the spotters from Next this morning. They were saying 2 to 4 seconds, depending on conditions and driver. So if Matto can make up that time there, then it's just gone up to 8 as well, Jared. So he's obviously made a little mistake because we see a couple of cars side by side. Might be Deegan and Martin, I think, in the background. So 1.5 seconds now, the gap for Michaela Arlen Kotlinski. Definitely came here for me as a great guest driver, but not necessarily somebody you were expected to go and smash it against some of the best side-by-side racers out there. And Michaela is just absolutely flying. This is a brilliant performance. She's just going to hold on for another half a lap, and it's going to be a fantastic victory.
Racing is racing, you know what I mean? So overall, she's got great race craft.
She's Kevin Hansen's teammate in Extreme E, in Jenson Button squad, the Formula One world champion, signing her up earlier on this year.
All right, so Matto will be having to hit that Yokohama Tire Joker lap, but Michaela, she's off to the races. And here comes Matto. Matto should be taking it, and there he goes. So let's see if he gains a position or not at all. It looks like he's coming in tight.
8.5 back, but it was a long way up the road, wasn't it? It's 4.9. So it looks like
jumps into third. Yep, boom, yeah. Right there. Jumps in front of Haley Deegan.
So it looks about 5 seconds in, Jared.
Yeah. All right, so as Michaela out front, Willis in second, Matto in third, Deegan in fourth. The checkered flag is out, and Michaela Arlen Kolinski gets the win. Willis in second, and Robbie Madison, who was in fifth, jumps up to third. Haley Deegan notably fourth. You got Martin in fifth. And looks like Rollins and Michaela will finish it out. But we saw Lawrence Williams, we got Bilko and Berza. They are all out. But Bilko sitting on his tire waving to the fans. But overall, very impressive on Michaela. What do you think of that, the side-by-side racing there, Benito?
I really like it. It looks like really fun to drive. This kind of suspension in the side-by-side, it's really, really fun. Someone is doing the donuts, celebrating.
I think that might be Bilko.
Yeah. Congratulations. It's amazing. And it's so nice to be here, guys. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks for coming. We're excited to have you next year. Yeah. We hope you can make it work. So, let's keep our fingers crossed.
Yeah, I will swap the microphone for a helmet and a
heartbeat.
So thank you very much, guys.
Oh, thank you, man. And again, Stage Rally coming over here, Nitro Rallycross. Obviously, we'd love to have you in the introduction of electrification. Have you sat in the car yet?
Yeah, I sat yesterday, and it's really different because of the batteries that are in the floor. It's like you are very high in on the steering wheel. It's going to be different, but it's going to be really nice.
Awesome. Well, thank you for joining us here. Let's take a look at the replay here of Nitro Rallycross side-by-side finals. Again, congratulations, Michaela. And, thank you so much. And that's where Bilko, he lost it. He went end over end. And looks like the 615 finishing up. And here's Bilko. Breaks off the Australian flag once again. Ends up on his tires, but just sustained too much damage. That's a double flip there.
615 is Hubert, who was just doing a huge amount of donuts down at the first corner. He promised us yesterday he didn't like breaking cars because he didn't like repairing them. But certainly went for it there. Bilko, yeah, it's a shame, isn't it, to see him go over. That was looking to be a great race.
When he was up here, he said, I'm either DNF or going to win the race. Well, guess what?
Yeah.
DNF again.
Lived up to the reputation of one or the other, at least.
So Michaela came out on top. This is where Matto came in, slid into the DMs, and gets that number three spot. Robbie Madison from jumping out of a plane to sliding into third place. Congratulations to them. And looks like clearing the track. And like you said, Hubert doing some celebratory burnouts. I mean, I don't know, celebratory for getting last place. I don't know if that's a really great celebration. Join us up here in the booth is our pit reporter, a man of the people. There's Michaela, Holland Kolinsky, Corey Willis, and Robbie Madison. You're 1, 2, and 3. Join us up here, Trevor Pirana, man of the people, doing beer bongs, just slamming party, slamming good times. How we doing, bud?
It's an absolute honor to be up here, man. This next race coming up is one of my most exciting things I think is going to happen today. And it's these are my kind of people, man. You know, at some point, somebody made a comment about the Olympics and said, for every event in the Olympics, there should be one average person competing for perspective. This is that race right here. Most people in the audience haven't probably seen a rally car in person or sat behind the wheel of one, but I guarantee a large portion of people watching have owned some of these vehicles out here and are probably just as capable as some of these drivers out here. So you're really going to get to see how you would do on this course in your own car.
The Pit Viper happy hour-ish is what we like to call it. That's coming up. Here's, again, those celebratory burnouts. Is that Bilko or Hubert?
I can't tell.
That's about Matto right there.
That's Matto, yeah. And then Hubert was down there as well. And the celebrations you were seeing, that was Michaela Arlen-Kotlinski. There she is down. She's down with Sandra Holtgren was down there. That's the Hansen family too. Kenneth's down there. Look, great result. Great drive.
Yeah, really upset to see Bilko go out the way he did.
Yeah.
He was really challenging her for second place yesterday. So, really bummer to see him get out.
And that's Scotty Lawrence, who's running the cars for them this weekend as well. So, yeah, all going off down there. Great
stuff. Trevor Pirana here. He's going to give us some great insight on what's going down. The Pit Viper happy hour-ish. Two laps. What kind of vehicles are we seeing now? What kind of specimens are behind the wheel?
Oh, I mean, everything from SUVs, trucks. There's actually a BMW X5 out there, which might be a little overclassed for some of the other stuff. There's some Ford Rangers, a Dodge 1500, and pretty much anything you thought you knew about racing, you can just go ahead and throw it out the window right now. There's no points penalties for contact. If anything, that's encouraged. And a lot of these vehicles here have a high rollover potential. These vehicles here are the ones that are responsible for the rollover stickers on the visors of most modern cars.
And here we go. I know Uncle Chet is out there chilling with Chet. We got Jim York. So, Bull Chet, I don't know if you've seen that graphic. That's a one-off graphic. I know there's money on the line here. Oh, is that the largest Subaru I've ever seen. Leading the pack. That's JH, my boy JH Diesel. JH, who's your money on?
I really want to see come over Steve really do really, really well out there. I'm not sure what vehicle he's in or if he even made the field, but he should be out there. He's in a Dodge Dakota, actually.
Apparently he hasn't made it. I don't know why, Trevor. I can't imagine. Can you?
I can't imagine. He was getting bathed last night in the shower of a motorhome. Yeah. I can only imagine why he didn't make the field today.
He just wanted to smell fresh. Wanted to smell real fresh.
Against his own will.
Yes. So JH is killing it out there. And again, you got Chill with Chet. You got Uncle Chet. Look at the high-performance suspension as they hit that ZipRecruiter tabletop.
It doesn't even look like they're racing. They're just stuck in
the afternoon
traffic.
Oh, we got contact.
There it is.
There you go. So there's $100 on the line and a tattoo for anybody that puts one of these on the roof today.
Okay.
Wow. So that's the most they're actually racing for. There's no real money here. It's all just bragging rights. But that tattoo and the $100, that's the trophy if you can get it done.
Well, I think Jim York is going for the flip over, hence the Pit Viper graphics upside down already. So if you can read this roll me over kind of thing.
Preemptive.
So he's in the 69 Ford Explorer out there, Jim York. And who's this? And the largest Subaru ever made, that's JH Diesel.
Double bounce on all these cars, Jared. Look at the damper setup's just brilliant on them, isn't it? Absolutely amazing.
I believe 69 in the Dodge there is one of the Millers.
Oh, roll! Big roll!
Oh, there we go.
The jump.
That's Jim York.
Yeah, he did it.
And he keeps it going. Jim York with the rollover and keeps it going.
I think he had the windows open as well. That is pretty unreal, to be honest.
Well, I mean, between the Pit Viper sticker upside down and the 69 number, it reads 69 either way, man.
He knew what he was doing. He set that car up. But I think he might have just taken the win there. He might have just claimed himself the $100 in the tattoo.
As well as the roll. Wow.
And I believe that's chilling with Chet there in the Bull Chet Jeep. I don't know if you've seen that. Have you seen the livery there? I mean, how many 69s are out there? There's a lot of 69s.
I think that everyone has the same mentality, childish demeanor. They're all kind of looking for the same number.
My name's Jared, and I like to party. What's your name?
Trevor from Ron. I love to party.
Oh, I love to party. Andrew Coley, what's your name?
I'm Andrew Coley, and I like to party.
Dude, that's crazy. We all like to party. And so do these guys. Chilling with Chet out here, JH Diesel.
Oh, Jim spins it out. 36720.
Oh, wow.
Really bringing freestyle to the race here.
Dude, flair like TGI Fridays in the 90s. Looking good. Oh, so I don't know what lap we're on, but just regardless, it's a good show.
This is it coming around for the win. Looks like that giant Subaru.
The largest Subaru ever made.
Oh, bounce.
I believe that's JH Diesel or Chillin' with Chet, and we'll see. And, yeah, that looks like JH down there getting the victory, putting on a show in the largest Subaru ever made. It's more of like a Noboru.
This is the most cars we've ever had finish one of these races as well.
Yeah. I think it's because you safely knocked it down to two laps. Yeah. That's the most that any of those vehicles had in the tank.
Oh, we got some Bernies going on, Salvatore, the Bull Chet twin Jeeps. And then, is this that Blazer barely making across?
There it is. That's how you celebrate. Look, we're burning out diffs rather than tires here.
Now it's just turning into demolition derby down if you're trying to get off the track.
I mean, just this whole year, Trevor, again, this is the first. I mean, you were actually out there racing. Which were you at Glen Helen?
I was at ERX and Glen Helen.
That's
I raced
right.
The minivans, got taken out in turn one, and then I got second in Glen Helen. And it's not so much a driver's skill, it is just kind of like Russian roulette with what vehicle do you get?
Yeah.
And is it capable of making it four laps consecutively?
So two laps in this case. The fans loving it, and I know we are too. I mean, I like what you said about Olympics. There should be an average athlete amongst other people. But let's take a look back here at the Pit Viper Happy Hour. It all started in Salt Lake City drifting limos.
Yeah.
Right? And then it just progressively got gnarlier. And here we are blowing up cars in North Florida.
Yeah, clearly the limo drifting was a little too hard to judge. They had to get into some form of racing. And it's just basically whatever area of the country they're in, they kind of find the most popular vehicle. And they just seem to find enough of them to get a field going. So.
Well, there's Jim York jumping off his vehicle, his Ford Explorer. He flipped it. He gets $100 and a tattoo, courtesy of Pit Viper. I mean, it is his company, so no big deal.
Yeah.
But regardless, let's take a look back how it all began in Utah, round one. Here we are, round five, and we're jumping Subarus with Bulch. I don't even know. Let's take a look back. Look at this. Yeah, we are in Utah, Utah Motorsports Campus, Salt Lake City, Utah. Woo-hoo! So we're going for the big gap here, and Scott Speed has the lead. He's got the clean air.
He's off the inside line.
Oh!
Six car, five car around the outside line. Pula back into one piece, but it is the 2018 Nitro Rallycross winner who's going to make it two out of three, and the Hansons are unbeaten in Nitro Rallycross.
Cars that fly, and that's proven to be true. Round two of Nitro Rallycross here at ERX. Hansen gets the chip. Tanner Faust almost landed on Hansen.
Backward hit the wall with the front right of the Subaru. If Pastrana can hold around the outside, he could be inside of the hairpin at the top of the hill.
Oh,
Pastrana's got him done.
Gets the pass.
Scott Speed takes his first Nitro Rallycross win. His teammate Travis Pastrana right behind him. What a great way to end the weekend here at ERX.
That's right. The Nitro Rallycross Championship continues here at Wild Horse Pass.
Arpin is on the inside line. That is the impossible move, I'm telling you. Watch him now, bottom middle. He gets a little nudge on the right-hand side, I think actually from Kyle Busch.
That thing's been punched up. It looks like a low. Fras gets into the...
Pastrana versus Hansen on row one. So important to get a good start, but it will fit for Timmy. Oh, you're on form with Pastrana as he lands from one of the big jumps. Here comes the 199 going to jump into the arena for a brilliant win. He got the TQ. He takes the win in Arizona. Yes, Trapana!
Cars that fly, tracks that thrill. Look at this in-car, front of the go. Let's set it here, Glenn Helen.
Dorn tries to squeeze Jimmy Hansen their side.
Oh, look at that.
Corner, a bit of contact. Corner, Ericsson trying for the move. Oh, he must be on the inside speed.
To the inside.
Oh!
Looks like Scott Speed just got him out.
Yeah, is he? That's the jump which the team were telling me needed to have more pace on. So yesterday he just had enough clearance pace, and that's fine. Either Kevin saw him coming or he spotted
his shoulder because he jinked on right. There. Yeah.
Absolutely. Backward has closed down on McConnell.
Valdez, yes, but they got three seconds forward. And Dorn gets in. Hansen goes high.
Shut the door. Pastrana's got the inside line. Get him. And it's a perfect 1-2-3 stop for Subaru.
Well done there. You can see Pastrana's speed. They are looking in absolute formation. Be the first ever Nitro Rallycross podium without a Hansen.
Pastrana goes to Florida as the title favorite.
The first win at Glen Helen.
Stanley Cup playoff game.
Spectacular purpose-built courses.
Decided to build one of the wildest tracks ever.
Incredible locations, from the desert to the snow. Huge jumps.
Wow, it's like they're launching out of a machine gun.
And drama at every turn.
This is literally the best, the wildest Rallycross in the existence of the history of Rallycross.
Welcome to Nitro Rallycross.
In 2018, Nitro Rallycross took the racing world by storm with the biggest jumps, the best drivers, and the most intense action ever. In 2021, Nitro Rallycross is expanding with five epic races. From the mountains to the Great Lakes, the desert, and the Sunshine State, Nitro Rallycross is coming to a racetrack near you. Nitro Rallycross, the series, revving up and taking off this September.
Final round of Nitro Rallycross Championship at the Firm. This track is absolutely awesome, and it's unique because it is mostly pavement. Coming into the first turn, pretty narrow, 90-degree right, easy to overshoot, especially on your flying lap. And then you got two more corners. You have the option to go straight and hit the joker or turn right and hit this big old gap jump. Now, it's going to be interesting that first lap if everyone decides to hit the gap. There's going to be a lot of cars in the air coming around this pretty wide sweeping corner, but it's really, really narrow and really slick getting back onto the pavement, bringing some of that Florida sand clay on. Then you got a couple of the corners that the road car guys are definitely going to shine on. Not exactly my forte coming out of there, but you have the lights and the side-by-side joker to the right. We go through the grass a little bit and then onto this super, super high-speed, narrow outer ring. Now, this is really neat because you got to get really in tight coming up here for the dirt section. Easy to get too sideways there. This is where the joker comes back in, and we'll be going a little bit tighter than this for the races today. We had a lot of trouble with the tires as we were going over the road completely sideways through here, but we'll be coming back on off-camber jump into the sand section, working on getting some clay there for the day, but we will see how that pans out tomorrow. This is going to be awesome. We got a big old tabletop. And then the sand continues onto the final straightaway and back into turn one at 120 miles an hour. Just getting it.
Hey, Pirana down here, and you know, I'm a man of the people. I like to get in the stands every once in a while and check out the vibe. We're down here kind of feeling it out, but what I really want to know is who's here to see Travis try and win this thing? Yeah! All right, Trav, you got the people on your side. Let's get this party started.
My name is Travis Pastrana from Annapolis, Maryland. I drive for Subaru Motorsports USA.
Side-by-side jump here, maybe over the big hit. Both the Subarus, amazing.
Wow, that is what Travis was hoping for, and they beat Extreme into the turn.
I got into action sports through my parents. They both love motorcycles. I started racing, then I loved rally, got into car racing, freestyle motocross, and now rallycross. When we're going to all the tracks, I'm making sure that I'm not putting anyone on that track until I've jumped all the jumps, until we've worked out all the damages, all the pitfalls, all the breaks. And I'm very fortunate to be with a company of Subaru that is taking a lot of money that no one will ever see and investing it into building this series. It's been a wild ride. We have three tracks to build, and we're going to get it done, and they're going to be absolutely amazing.
And you know what happens when Travis Pastrana thinks of things? Well, they become big and they become exciting.
And we are taking a look at Pastrana's car, getting freshened up, getting some new Yokohama tires on it, as he is just waiting, kind of buffering right now, the wheels spinning, because next stop for that vehicle and Travis are the finals. But up first, the LCQ, and Coley, notably, only one driver from the one LCQ heat will advance on to forge our eight-car supercar final.
Yeah, that's because we've got three heat races. So the consequence of smaller heat races, which maybe gives people fairer, cleaner racing, that was the idea behind it. The teams were like, can we try three smaller races? Yep, no problem. Travis is open to try stuff. The other side of that is you end up with eight cars in the LCQ.
Yeah.
So only one going through, you know, could be exciting.
Well, this is Travis is a real contender overall, and we'll see if some other people. Oh, this is it. Oh, guess what? This is the Power Plus power move of the day. It's Travis Pastrana, and notably, I mean, just the excitement, what he had to do under pressure. He provided the power, and he provided the control.
It was first thing today. It was the first thing we saw, and you know, we were all kind of getting fired up for Championship Day. The pressure for Travis was huge, and for me, it was actually what capped it, Jared, was the reaction in the car when he took the checkered flag. You were left in no doubt at all what it meant to him. He said, it was the pavement driving my life. I'm not good at this, and he beat one of the best in the world in Kevin Hansen. Great drive.
And Scott Speed even said that. He was like a proud father.
Oh,
he says, oh, look.
Yes!
That says it all. You can charge a phone with that energy. You know what I mean? Like, you can charge the city with that. We got it done. And that is rightfully deserving of the Power Plus power move of the day. Well done. There is NORAD for Subaru. And guess what? All Subarus are in. Sorry, I didn't mean to scare you, buddy.
They are. They are all there having a little look at the data, trying to figure everything out. We've got a little bit of dust coming up into the commentary box because they're sorting out a couple of oil spills from the previous race.
Yeah.
And obviously we want the racing to be as clean as it possibly can be for supercar. LCQ, you can see, is on the grid. That's the cleanup. So they're down there with sweepers, and you put down this special dust which soaks up the fluids in the car.
They've
got leaf blowers down there as well. So they're doing their best, but I expect that's going to change both the braking zone and also the grip in turn one. So the drivers are going to need to be ready for it to be a little bit more slippery.
All right, so as we are seeing the track being cleaned up and our LCQ, the O'Reilly Auto Parts last chance qualifier, Will got an update about that gentleman right there, Frazier McConnell. Will?
Yeah, Jared, Andrew, Fraser was not happy with the decision that got made there, the five-second penalty. The contact was between him and Oliver Bennett there at that jump. And when I went and spoke to Fraser, he said, look, it doesn't seem right to me. That just seemed like racing. Interestingly enough, I'd already spoken to Ollie Bennett just a few minutes beforehand, and even he said, I think that was a racing incident. Obviously, the result didn't massively make too much difference there for Ollie Bennett, but it did for Fraser McConnell. He was definitely upset when we saw him get in the car. Guys, I don't know what your opinion is on what happened there, but from their perspective, this is something really that shouldn't have resulted in him being here now on the grid for the LCQ.
I mean, that's... You never want to be in the LCQ. The name gives away that it's a bit of a shocker. I don't know. You know, in theory, the standard lap is the one that you're supposed to give way to. Fraz tried to go around it. You know, we've had quite a bit of carnage today.
Yeah, carnage is an understatement. I mean, from Arpin going off, I mean, multiple red flags. We had a restart there. And this, notably, was a huge hit. That Liam Doran, bang, gets pinched.
Doran, by the way, I can see on the back of the grid for the LCQ. To go from P7 to P1 is going to be a big ask, but he is there. That was what happened to Liam's car. The rear wheel came off, and they've managed to get the car fixed up and ready to go. That's the RX Cartel, who, of course, run by EKS JC, so hats off to them. They've done quite a bit of rebuilding this year with the car alongside Liam Cabot Bigham's car, which had to be completely... I'll be honest, I didn't think we'd see that again this season when that shunt happened, and they got it fixed up and ready to go. So much work to do from back there, Jared. You know, they need turn one to play in their favour. They want a few people to run wide. You know, you need the Joker strategy to play out. So, yeah, it's tough.
Yeah, the Never Surrender Award presented by Yokohama Tire went to Cabot Bigham. And if you didn't see it earlier in our broadcast, you can go back and look. Cabot Bigham, you know, the suspension, you know, breaking off at round one and then the big flip at two. But here is our LCQ. Eight drivers, only one will move on to join the other seven in the finals. Kevin Erickson and Fraser McConnell in the front row. Tanner Faust, Ollie Bennett, Oliver Erickson, and Ronald Baldens in row three. And they're finishing up that row four, Liam Doran, the British bomb, and Mr. Follow the Ham, Cabot Bigham. Coley, do what you do best. Hit that 10,000, 15,000, 20,000 RPM. Let's send it! Here for LCQ.
Brakes on. Here we go. Erickson versus McConnell on the front row. They've both been quick today. Who's going to get the best start? Wheel spin from both cars on the run down to the first corner. McConnell made it slightly ahead, but he doesn't have the inside. Looking to try and go around the outside. They're through the dust of the cleanup. McConnell gets the whole shot. Where's he going to go? Straight to the Joker lap. Oh, and into the standard lap. Erickson gets a little shunt from behind by Tanner Faust in the 34. They all clear over the jump. Liam Doran up behind Ollie Erickson. Five cars on the standard lap. And it is Fraser McConnell who leads off the cars that have chokered.
And this is, I mean, this is a lot going on, and this is a great teaser, but keep in mind, this is three laps, the final six laps, same amount of cars, but you see how just precarious it gets out there. Big names, Erickson, Faust.
Brilliant decision by Fraser McConnell. Look at the five cars racing, Jared, racing quite hard from that standard lap. We're hearing again from Tanner Faust spotter, but looking at Fraser McConnell, he's jokered from the lead, got the whole shot, then went joker. 6.0, he's already within reach of the leader.
Yeah, I mean, that is a really well-done execution. Look at the focus of Fraz McConnell. He's got a lot of fans here in the building cheering him on from his home country of Jamaica. They are flying the flags, and you can hear it absolutely erupt. 5.8. Coley, that is really, that's on the mark. He could get the lead if he holds his gap.
What's absolutely crucial now is whether the others go or not. I think they'll have to wait. Tanner Faust goes. Faust has gone to try and cover him off. I think McConnell will get him. Oh, as McConnell dropped it in turn one.
Good job.
Someone's off in turn one. It's Fraser McConnell's gone off in the first corner. The car's parked in the dust. He had a spin in turn one. It's all over for him. Big reset now. Tanner Faust has taken the joker, and he's 7 seconds down the road. Kevin and Ollie Erickson have just been held up, I think, by Fraz. So this might now go to Faust.
Wow, look at this again. Only one car can move on. Tanner Faust with that 7 second split, but both the Ericksons, Kevin and Ollie, are one and two. Look at it, and the gap closes. Tanner Faust, he's going to have to work hard, but he's going to have to keep it clean.
Oh, poor old Fravs. We didn't see what happened to him. He was on for it, and we were rightly looking to see who was going to go Joker. But I really thought that the big issue I thought was going to be catching up to Cabot Biggerman. He was 3 seconds up the road. It was all looking
good.
They're
closing the gap. Give it everything here. We've cleared them.
Right, give it everything and we can clear them, says his spotter. There's Fraser Park on the outside of turn two. He's absolutely gutted in the car. There you go. Fraz, we feel for you, mate.
White
it
flag.
Was on. Everybody knows how fast you are, mate. It just hasn't gone. It hasn't come together. Ericsson's go Joker.
They have
turn
to.
About,
this is the final lap.
Here we go. So the Ericsson's go for the Joker lap. Get Tanner Faust clear him. The spotter in his ear saying go
clear
for it.
Tanner Faust
takes the lead from the Ericsson's.
Brilliant drive by Faust.
Here's Rosane.
Should be clear. Clear, clear, clear. You're clear by two. That's two car lengths. The Ericsson's were playing together
one
there. You'd expect them to
now.
Do that.
Go
one
two.
Car back. Kevin's coming in hot. Can he get close enough to have a look at Tanner before the end of the race?
Look at Kevin. He is already breathing down the neck of Tanner Faust, one of the best American rallycross drivers ever. And Kevin Ericsson, look at that. He is hitting all the rumble strips as we look in at Fraz.
Broken drive train for Fraser McConnell, apparently. Absolutely gutting. Drops it in the first corner. But Tanner Faust has only got a couple of corners to go.
Three back, no trend.
Three back, he's saying. So keep the door shut. Got a left-hander to go. And Tanner Faust is going to take that last spot in the final. It sweeps it around the left-hander. Ericsson trying to line him up to out-track
okay,
him down
clear,
the straight.
The
up and over the tabletop. They jump back in now. Tanner Faust going to take
job.
The last
in
spot
the
in the final here for the last final of the year at Nitro Rallycross. Great drive.
Great driving by Tanner Faust. Again, he didn't take that Joker lap. All signs are
well,
saying Fraser McConnell.
Right now.
As we're eavesdropping on Tanner Faust and his spotter. And there is Tanner, so really, really
I mean,
well
let's
done.
Fucking do this. If we're gonna stick around for another hour, let's just do it.
He says it's gonna be hard for me to make my flight now. This gentleman's been all over the world. I don't know if you've seen, but he is jet setting. He flew in to get here to get
there.
He was in the UK last week. I popped back home for a bit. Tanner was over there testing for McLaren and Extreme E. So, yeah, he's such a busy guy, always filming movies and things. So, he doesn't spend a lot of time at home. I imagine the air miles are good.
Crowder cheering here.
Well, he's a pilot himself. I mean, I know Chase Elliott flew here by himself, but some great racing here. Let's take a look back. This is how it all began. Fraser McConnell taking that Joker lap right from the jump. Liam Dorn getting into it with that of that was Tanner Faust, actually. So, again, take a lick and keep on ticking. You can see Kevin Ericsson and Tanner jumping over Fraser McConnell. Kevin, that big Honda, it sounds weird. Yes, big Honda by comparison to somebody's hot hatchback. The way that car was rotating looks really good, and Kevin still had a little more horsepower, a little more oomph. But there was Tanner in tow, but when he took that Joker lap, that's when he took it. So he's in an Ericsson sandwich, but then he came out on top after he hit that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. So this is Kevin out front, Ollie just behind him. And here's Fraser McConnell, a bit of bad luck. You see him going to the turn one, rotates, spins. Talking about just the gremlins. Oh, it looks like he got hit by Ollie Bennett. So he got hit by Ollie when he spun out. And here's Tanner's execution. So here's Kevin Ericsson, Ollie Ericsson, and here comes Tanner. Hey, boys, how's it going? Yeah, just going to take this lead from you real quick. Yeah.
He jumped long, didn't he? It was like Timmy did, I think, earlier on, jumping long to try and get that little margin. I'm told by his spotter, you've got the line, do what you want, and gives it a nice old sideways one around the barrels. It was just a lovely bit of car control. Kevin didn't give up, though, either, did he?
No, Tanner Faust turned to Tanner first. Look at this. Look at that. Absolutely well done. Bravo, Tanner.
I can't help but feel a bit sorry for Fraser. I thought it was a great move to go Joker from the lead, Jared. It was ballsy to do that because you can get yourself straight into traffic, but it worked out perfectly. And, of course, lap two, broken drive train, and he was out. Would have been close between him and Tanner.
Well, you saw when he rotated there in turn one, and then Ollie Bennett came up, and bam, he hit him too. So insult to injury. It's been a tough go for Fraser McConnell, but I'll tell you what. Fraz will still have a smile on his face. His family's here. He's got a bunch of fans cheering him on, and it's just an unfortunate turn of events. Those are the gremlins. They show up. You can't feed them after midnight. You can't get them wet because they start to multiply. As there we see Tanner Faust gets the win in the LCQ, but guess what? That just gets him in the final with seven other very fierce competitors, who three of which are going for the championship. And Tanner Faust, he's just trying to catch a flight.
he caught a flight as he said, flew over the Erickson Burrows and took that win. So very well done. And here's how the finals will shape up. Next up, we'll be seeing our Nitro Rallycross next final with eight cars as well. And there it is. So Scott Speed and Timmy Hansen on the front row. Pastrana behind his Subaru teammate, Kevin Hansen. So look at that. You got Subarus on the left side, Hansen on the right side. So we talked about Scott having the perfect event. He's your number one qualifier. He gets that, you know, the bracket battle win. Arpin and Larson. Arpin, you know, almost got knocked out with those double re-racks. Robin Larson. Chase Elliott, 2020 NASCAR champion. He is in the mix of that Go Nitro powered by ZipRecruiter vehicle. And then Tanner Faust gets the final number eight spot. So when we come back, Nitro Rallycross continues here at the Firm in North Florida. Next up, we'll be seeing Nitro Rallycross next. And those are the 300 horsepower all-wheel drive hot hatchbacks. And here it is, Coley. We are set to see this. The 32nd card is up. All thriller, no filler. Let's jump right into it. This is Nitro Rallycross next on the front row. Sage Karam and Connor Martell. These guys have a lot of open wheel experience. Casper Janssen and Martin Edlund, they're fighting for the championship. George McGinnis and Lane Vaquela, row three. And finally, bringing up row four, Kyle Schwartz and Eric Gordon. The championship is up for grabs. Separated by 25 points?
25 points over the top four drivers. Casper Janssen has just a 10-point lead. Sage Karam is only 15 behind total. And he's up on pole on the front row of the grid. So Sage Karam with a run down to the first corner. Connor Martell going to slot in behind up the inside of Hindlo goes. It must be, yeah, Casper Janssen's gone through. So Janssen's gone through. Edlund looking for a way through. So Casper Janssen slots up immediately into P2. Then he runs wide and Connor Martell gets up the inside and into him. But he holds on. So if Janssen can hold on there, we're in really early days, Jeremy. If he can hold on there, he'd take the title because Sage Karam won't be able to make a lot of points on him.
So as Sage Karam got the win yesterday, he's just worrying about up front. He's not even looking at his mirrors right now. He's just got to keep his nose clean. And I think this course obviously favors his driving style because he got the win yesterday. Casper Janssen, Connor Martell, and then you can see McGinnis there in fourth.
So, yeah, Janssen, as we said, leads the title fight. Where's Edlund? Has Edlund dropped down? Edlund's in P5. The top four drivers have all gone Joker on lap one, which we'd expect. It's a shorter Joker for them. Doesn't really matter to Janssen if Karam gets away from him, Jared, because it's only a 5-point difference between Sage Karam. He's 15 points behind Casper Janssen. If he holds on to P2, he's the NRX next champion. But Martell and McGinnis behind are going to make that mission very difficult indeed.
All right, Sage Karam coming on through. So again, if you can repeat, Casper Janssen has the points lead. Sitting in second, Martin Edlund. So there's 10 points separating Janssen and Edlund.
And then another five back to Sage Karam. So at the minute, he's only going to make five up on him. Janssen will have been... Oh, McGinnis has got past Martell in the background. McGinnis has got past Connor Martell. Sage Karam a couple of seconds up the road from Janssen. And the gap now back is massive. So I wonder if Martell made a mistake, Jared, because Casper Janssen's got no pressure. He had tons of it before. Now McGinnis runs deep. Martell gets back through. I think that McGinnis has cut the course. He'll get a penalty for that 100%.
I think not only has he cut a course, but I believe he's potentially cut a tire. He is not 100%.
I think Martell's not happy. I think something's happened there between those two, Jared, because the way that he kept his foot in when he knew he'd cut the course and then the way Connor's hit him back, that just strikes me as you do that to me, I'll do that to you. Right. So we didn't see it. It doesn't matter too much to us. Edlund has got himself up into P3. And Edlund was second in the standings, but he's got to get in front of Casper Janssen by 10 points if he wants to stand a chance of taking it. And Janssen has more wins, so he needs cars in between as well.
So a third of the way through this race, six-lap race. This is for the win here, round 10 of Nitro Rallycross next, and the first ever 2021 Nitro Rallycross next champion.
Isn't it cool that he's gone to the last round?
You know, I think it's great.
10 rounds, you've only got five. I kind of expected the main title fight might go to the last round. But when you've got 10 rounds, I wasn't figuring that these guys would be going for it on the very last race of their season. But Casper Janssen just 2.2 seconds back of Sage Karam. McGinnis has dropped down to sixth now. Eric Gordon did make it out, did he, after he rolled the car? Yes, he did. So that's good to see Eric out at least.
The whole variety of necks is what I really like. And again, just the next drivers learning the craft, you know, getting in, I mean, taking their disciplines of racing and bringing it here to Rallycross. This is a great introduction to just jumping into supercars. Again, we talked about it all day and all year, just about momentum and carrying that speed and just a variety of tracks we've seen.
Jansen backing it in. Look at the talent, Jared. I think that's the thing, is these guys, I was going to say kids, but it's not fair. They vary a bit, but most of them are fairly young. We've got, you know, Sage Karam and Colin Hunter,
Younger than us.
McGinnis is 16, so some of them, you know, really are teenagers. A few in the mid-20s. Eric Gordon, I think, is about our age. Go on, Eric, get it. But it's, you know, there's a lot of talent in this series. We've seen a lot of different winners.
Sage Karam still out front, but it's all eyes are on Casper Jansen. As long as he holds that position, that car number 36, he will be your 2021 Nitro Rallycross next champion. So Sage Karam, who gets the win, but it's not going to be enough if Jansen finishes right there in that position.
Rotates the car so well, doesn't he? You see that there, almost three-wheeling, just the rear left up in the air, that taking away a little bit of grip and making the rear of the car turn in for him nicely. You got to all the road too, just out to the edge of the dirt, but not onto it.
You got to think about this too. This is the longest course that we've seen this year. Also, this is the most laps we've seen these next cars do. This is when attrition really comes into play. The most asphalt, right? So all I'm saying is, right now it looks like we got a little bit of a parade lap, a victory parade lap for Casper Jansen. There's still a lap plus left.
Jared, he'll be hearing every single landing, like, multiplied by 10. That crashing noise that you normally just ignore and keep it lit. Everyone will be thinking, don't break, please don't break. And the car probably won't, but in the back of your mind, he may well know that he will know. He'll know that the only person in front of him can't beat him in the points as they are. And I just gnaws away at you. You don't need the distraction. You need to focus on the driving.
And also keep in mind, if Sage finishes here in Enlin, there could be some switching, changing of the guards on second and third overall in the championship.
Yeah, he's only 5 points behind Enlin, so that would be impressive from Kram, who missed round one in Utah as well.
This is very similar. This rivals that of the supercar. We have three contenders, right? You have Timmy Hansen, Scott Speed, and Pastrana. Here you have Sage Karam, Martin Enlin, and Casper Jansen going for that championship.
Out onto the back part of the circuit, Karam using the curb on the inside line. Enlund is not close enough to hold off Karam, and I doubt that his spotters are going to be telling him, because there's nothing that Enlund can do about it from where he is. But
right,
Karam may know that he's going to get P2. He wanted P1, and he'll continue to push in the hopes that something happens to Casper behind. But he's now just got one lap to go, Jared.
I'm not taking it as a final lap at the white flag, which means one last lap. I'm taking it as a mercy lap here, because Casper Jansen has been really dominant here, but Sage Karam as well. But it's just not enough, because it's all about a culmination of 10 rounds, you know, kicking this thing off in Utah, making our way to ERX, to Minnesota, which I thought was going to be the most dynamic, and we are going to peak at that track. No, Phoenix, Glen Helen, and now here at the firm.
A little big moment, because in his head it will be a big moment. It was only a small moment for Jansen. He was a little bit sideways on the dirt, but look at the gap he's got behind. He's comfortable here. He's 6.2 up. It's half a lap to go. You know his parents and his family will be watching, and the team. They'll be praying that he makes it. He's nearly there.
Casper Jansen sitting in second. All eyes are on him, but Sage Karam dominant here this weekend. He won yesterday, round 9 of Nitro Rallycross Next. And really looking forward to seeing what he can do for 22. But Casper Jansen, you can see the dust flying.
Here comes Karam. He's on to the last left-handed corner, going to clear the tabletop. This is going to be Sage Karam's fifth win of the year. But it's not going to be enough to take the title. He'll take the flag here. It's a great display. But Casper Jansen is your 2021 NRX Next champion in his rookie season driving these cars. An incredible performance by that young man. Wow. P3 has gone to Martin Enlund, who I think will lose out on a championship position. He'll end up third, won't he, looking at the points. I think Karam will get past him.
Yeah, I mean, look at Sage Karam. That's his, like you said, his fourth win overall. Janssen, second place. He has three wins. And Martin Enlund with only one win. So I believe with that tiebreaker, you default to wins, right?
If they're equal on points, it will go back to wins. But I think Sage is 10 points up on Enlund. Enlund was third, wasn't he? So he'll get 10 points more, and that will put him in front. So it should be Janssen, Karam.
I believe it's 50, 45, 40. So it's 5 points. So there should be a tie as far as points. That's why we'll let the officials do it.
Me and Jared are terrible at maths. We're happy to admit it.
So Casper Janssen, there's your champion. But this is how it started. Sage Karam, like I said, he owned this track. He was absolutely dominant here from yesterday to today. Congratulations to him. Sage Karam in that Wix Filters Try and Reinbold vehicle, the number 24. But I'm excited just seeing the next vehicles and the eight vehicles, six lap final, the supercars. It's gonna get hairy. It's gonna get awesome. It's gonna get unreal. What an epic season here for the next drivers. A real great complimentary series and vehicle to that of supercars.
What do you do if you're Casper Janssen, Jared? He started racing these cars in the Nordic series earlier this year. He was pretty wild. Then he tied it up, got quick, got towards the front. Now he's come to Nitro, won the series at the first attempt. Where do you go? You know, they'll be trying, I'm sure, to find the money to make the move maybe to supercar, because after a season like that, I don't know what you do. And same for Sage Karam. He's had the most wins this year with 5 wins. If he hadn't missed Utah, Karam would be the champion.
Yeah.
So that's not taking anything away from Karam.
Yeah,
from Casper Janssen. You've got to be there. You've got to be there to take the points, and he wasn't. But
yeah. That is crazy.
So impressive.
No, he didn't miss. He just, I think, a DNF or a DNS. I don't think he was there at round one, which was Friday. So there it is. Look at Sage jumping out, congratulating Casper Janssen, helping him out.
That's good to see. That's really cool to see. Those guys have raced really hard, Jared. Don't forget, they've got into each other a few times, and that's lovely to see that respect between them.
There he is. Casper Janssen holds it up. The biggest trophy of the year, the 2021 Nitro Rallycross next champion, Casper Janssen. And let's throw it down to Will, who has him, to get his first words as he pops off his skid lid. Will?
Just give him 1 second there, Jared. Casper, congratulations. And an incredible season for you all round. You had a little bit of time to think there in those closing laps. What was going through your head knowing that you were about to clinch his championship?
I think no mistake. In Claret and... Yeah, it's really happy, and this is my first season in Rallycross, so I'm really happy.
So when you look back now at the beginning of the season, your expectations then and where you've ended up, could you believe that you've been in this position looking back?
No, but I have leveled up very much, and learned a lot of USA and here in Sweden or earlier Northern, and yeah.
I know this is a team effort, so go and enjoy with the rest of your team, Casper, and congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Just that young man there, humble as possible, and again, just part of the Enlund Motorsports team. You could see there, and holding up his country's flag. So much talent out of Sweden. I mean, just why is that?
Sport's huge there. It's kind of a homeland. Yeah, the Rallycross was created in the UK. First event was down at Lytton Hill. It's more than 50 years old as a sport. You know, this is Rallycross 2.0 with Nitro. We're going next level, which is cool. But the sport's been around a long time. It was invented for TV because of short, sharp racing. And over in Sweden, Norway, it's just hugely popular. So there's so many drivers, and they see it as a career, especially when you've got a series as popular as this where they can go. So Casper Janssen does take the title. Sage Karam just nips in front of Martin Enlund, and that's your podium.
Yep, so Martin Enlund finishes out, and that is overall for the championship. That's where it lands. So Casper Janssen, Sage Karam, and Martin Enlund, 1, 2, and 3 overall in the first ever Nitro Rallycross next championship. And speaking of next, guess what's next? Supercar final. We are seeing 8 cars, 6 laps, 1 winner, and 1 champion. Who's it going to be? Again, in contention, Timmy Hansen sits in third. Scott Speed sits in second, and Pastrana has that lead. But that's how our Nitro Rallycross next final podium finishes. Sage Karam in that Wix Filters Dry Reinbold vehicle in the Enlund Motorsports 2 and 3, Casper Janssen and Martin Enlund. When we come back, more Nitro Rallycross action, but there's only one stop on this party train, and that is Nitro Rallycross Supercar Finals to decide who will be our first ever Nitro Rallycross Supercar Champion. Will it be the 199 Travis Pastrana or Subaru teammate Scott Speed or Timmy Hansen? We'll find out when we come back.
In 2018, Nitro Rallycross took the racing world by storm with the biggest jumps, the best drivers, and the most intense action ever. In 2021, Nitro Rallycross is expanding with five epic races. From the mountains to the Great Lakes, the desert, and the Sunshine State, Nitro Rallycross is coming to a racetrack near you. Nitro Rallycross, the series, revving up and taking off this September.
Nitro, short for nitroglycerin, or an explosive yellow liquid made by nitrating glycerol, used in dynamite. So when things go nitro, they really go. Like this guy.
Everybody screams, everybody screams. That's my only thing, yes. I'm a born winner, a Jordan 23. All my PBGs until the party cease.
Or you guys.
Run it.
And now racing's going nitro. So watch out. Because nitro isn't just the fuel. It's a state of mind.
Run it.
From across the deserts to the mountains and countless racetracks in between, Yokohama Tire has a storied history in advancing drivers to new levels. Originating in the motorsports department in 1978, the Advan brand of Yokohama has spent over four decades allowing drivers to take their vehicles beyond what they thought was possible. While there is an endless amount of science and technology that goes into each tire, in the end, it's the connection between the driver and the tire.
With fancy cars like you get in Nitro Rallycross, you got a lot of super technical things. They're loud, they have a huge amount of horsepower, but in any machine, the thing that connects the machine to the road are the tires.
And it's awesome when you have a tire that gives you maximum grip, but when everything's about to let loose, you know you got it.
Going over big jumps like this, bank corners, fast corners, Yokohama Tires is what's got our back.
Nitro Rallycross and its drivers will start the next chapter in the Advan Tires legacy.
Here we go, Pastrana versus Speed.
Travis, to me, is the fun, cool, crazy kid that I love to watch but would hate to be like.
Scott Speed's got the edge on Travis.
He's super tidy, he's super clean, he doesn't like to fly, he doesn't like to slide.
The team owner says, don't crash out, we know it's your fault, Travis.
It's a perfect mesh of, we'll know which corners are better to do tidy and we'll know which corners are better to do wide open.
Speed carries a little bit more speed.
The first time I saw this jump in person, super intimidating, and Travis you know, explaining how easy it was did absolutely nothing to ease my fears.
I didn't really care.
That's game over. Scott Speed should take this.
There's Scott Speed coming across. Travis Pastrana in second.
Progress in making that.
I know you guys are doing important stuff, but wait, you want to do it on your shoe? Or you got to take it on my stinky shoe?
Rules, man.
Hey, give me a hook me up, man. I'm doing, I know it's a second, but I'm doing a shoe anyway, man.
So the big story right now is three drivers going for the championship, notably Travis Pastrana, Scott Speed, and Timmy Hansen. You can see the hand up right there. Yeah, that's Chase Elliott, 2020 NASCAR champion. He is in the mix. He's piloting that Go Nitro car powered by ZipRecruiter. So you have three Subarus up in the mix, two up front there on the left side. On the right side, you got the hand there. You know, when we come back, it all comes down to this. When we come back, Nitro Rallycross Supercar Finals.
Mind of action sports icon Travis Pastrana.
I mean, this is the only course in the world where cars literally fly.
Comes the next evolution in motorsports.
Landed on Hansen.
This is our Super Bowl. This is our Daytona 500. Our Stanley Cup playoff game.
Spectacular purpose-built courses.
Decided to build one of the wildest tracks ever.
Incredible locations, from the desert to the snow. Huge jumps.
Wow, it's like they're launching out of a machine gun.
And drama at every turn.
This is literally the best, the wildest rallycross in the existence of the history of rallycross.
Welcome to Nitro Rallycross.
Do you feel that, Coley? Do you feel that? The tension? Why are you sweating right now?
Freaking out.
Lost sleep.
Here we go.
I feel like you're ready. You're not winning the championship, but one of those guys is winning the championship. Is it Travis Pastrana? Is it Scott Speed? Is it Timmy Hansen?
Six laps and we get to find out is the short answer.
It's down to those three gentlemen. Pastrana notably wins that power plus power move because he had to do... and he executed what he needed to do. And that was get the win. And he toughed it out and beat a Hansen. Well, his fate was left in the other driver's hands, right? So the exuberation, the excitement, he got the win. He did what he needed to do. But then it was all about the other Hansen. Timmy Hansen had to get the win, and he did just that, meaning that he advanced himself to the front row here for the finals. Then in our final, heat three, we've never had three heats until here in Florida. Well, Scott Speed, his Subaru teammate, meeting Travis Pastrana, he had to win. Otherwise, Travis Pastrana would be on the front row. Scott Speed, absolutely dominated in his heat. So, Scott Speed, Timmy Hansen, front row. Behind the Subaru is Travis Pastrana in the second row. Behind the Hansen is the other Hansen. So you got Tim Hansen and then Kevin Hansen. And it was great. It was exactly what we'd expected, right? And there is our championship trophy up for grabs. 5 points separate Pastrana, Scott Speed, and then Timmy Hansen. You can see him back there waiting in the wings. What's that, that math thing again? What's it called? 16 points?
It's close. It's 16 points, yeah, between Timmy Hansen and Travis Pastrana. So he needs three cars in between. If Timmy were to win, he needs three cars between him and Travis and two cars between him and Speed. Travis must finish behind Scott Speed. If he finishes equal on points, he would win on countback. There's a bit of math, but it's mostly just sending awesomeness down to turn one, getting this job done after five brilliant rounds
All right, so with more dirt on literally this dirty track, I throw it down to Will, who's down in the Subaru pits. Will?
Guys, the atmosphere down here, I'm just going to let you take a look at Team Subaru right now and have a look on their faces. They just told me, you know, they're normally nervous, but they are more nervous than they have ever been. We know there's a lot on the line here. We've got driver championship, of course, the team championship as well. So right now, these guys are just ready for what is going to be an absolutely huge race for them. We're going to find out soon enough.
Bit of a smirk there for Travis Pastrana. He's kind of not the open face, but that stage rally helmet with that comms there. Scott Speed vying for the kind of full face. And there's, again, Timmy Hansen. So those three gentlemen, look at that. So where do you think that posture comes from?
I love the fact Timmy's clocked the fact that he's on. You know, he's just chilling. He's a thumbs up. He's ready to go. He's on the front row. Don't count him out. Don't count him out. We are getting ourselves ready to go.
And here is our grid. Scott Speed and Timmy Hansen on the front line. Pastrana behind his Subaru teammate and Kevin Hansen behind his brother. Third row, Steve Arpin, the Canadian Cowboy, Robin Larson, and bring up the rear, Chase Elliott and Tanner Faust. Let's send it! Andrew Coley and Nitro Rallycross Supercars here.
This is it then. Six laps to decide the first ever Nitro Rallycross Champion. Speed, Pastrana or Timmy. Great start. The front row to Scott Speed. Timmy Hansen gets moved across. Travis Pastrana gets a huge
sweep.
Oh, over the curbs on the inside line. Pastrana goes up the inside of his teammate. Timmy Hansen leads. Scott Speed goes around the outside and goes straight to the joker lap. That was a really aggressive move there from Travis Pastrana in turn one. He cut across the curbs on the inside line. I mean, yeah.
Wow. These are really expensive pinatas. And guess what? Scott Speed slowing down as he went through the joker lap. He is scrubbing a lot of speed. I definitely want to roll that back and see what happened. This is really interesting as far as what transpired there. Timmy Hansen now in front, Pastrana in second, Arpin in third.
So Scott Speed still going right now. Has he taken damage in that hit? Look how low the sun is. That's really going to affect the drivers as they come back through the wooded section. We're on lap 1 of 6. We had drama in the very first corner. Timmy leads from Pastrana. At the moment, as it stands, Travis Pastrana would win the Nitro Rallycross Championship. But that first corner, was he two wheels on?
What happened?
He went for it, dude. That's right. Kevin squeezed him on the outside. Kevin did what we thought he would do. Supported his brother. Squeezes Travis. Travis goes deep into turn one. Was the move on? I mean, we'll see. We'll have to take a look back. It happened so quickly. I wasn't expecting it so soon.
No, not at all. Chase Elliott bringing up the rear in that Go Nitro car powered by ZipRecruiter. Chase Elliott, NASCAR champion of 2020. Not part of the equation, but definitely part of the conversation. Here we go. Timmy Hansen goes for the jump. And Pastrana... And they're saying there's no infraction. They said that's a racing incident. And there we go. Double thumbs up for us as well as, I got to assume, the drivers as well.
Well, this is a race then for the championship between Hansen and Pastrana. Pastrana can afford to stay where he is. So much support for him here as he backs the big Subaru into the double right-handers. He's chasing Timmy Hansen, we know, is a real pavement expert. Travis doesn't need to win. He'll know that. It'd be nice to win. Always good to win a championship with a win. But he's just got a job to do. Keep that Subaru facing in the direction it needs to.
Because we talked about it on the front end right before. Look at the Yokohama tire marks in the side of Pastrana. 16 points separate our current leader, Timmy Hansen, and Pastrana as far as this race goes. But overall championship, again, 16 points. If this race right now, checkered flag, Pastrana wins the championship. But there are 4 laps left to go.
But it also nudges Speed down to P3, Jared, Timmy is far enough up the road here that if he finishes in front of Travis where he is, he'll edge Scott in terms of the points. Scott Speed is stuck down behind
Pastrana
Kevin
with his best lap, 106.68.
Yeah, so Pastrana's on a big, big push. And I'll say Kevin at the minute is in front of Scott Speed, so Scott's got to try and find a way past. It's kind of irrelevant. The race is just between the two out front. Timmy Hansen's gone joker. And Pastrana then, so Hansen now 6.1 back. Pastrana, that's the gap we've got to watch.
Also, keep in mind, I brought this up in the NASCAR, in the next car vehicles. This is the longest track we've seen, just over a mile, and the most pavement as well.
I'm interested why they've jokered Timmy when they jokered him. So they've jokered him and put him in behind with Kevin Hansen almost as his rear gunner. But I'm interested why they would joker him so soon. I would have expected them to wait until longer. So Pastrana leads on the road at the moment. The Hansens have pulled a bit of a move. They're very tactical. They'll know why they've done it and what they've done. So Kevin's right there for him. But Travis wasn't exactly hassling him.
So this is interesting, too. Look at this. Pastrana has not taken the Joker lap. Timmy has taken it 5.3 seconds, 5.1 seconds.
Kevin Hansen for the Danger Man. He's only 6.5 off the back. So Kevin Hansen's almost within shouting distance again in front of Pastrana. But they need three cars between Timmy and Pastrana to take the title away from Travis. So Travis is far enough up the road that they, if they want to edge him on the points, they've got to have three cars in between them. They'll be frantically working it out like we are. Pastrana's just hanging on out there.
And here we are riding with Scott Speed, who's back in P5, 7.2 seconds off the leader. But keep in mind, again, Pastrana has not taken that Joker lap, neither him or Arpin. Look at Hansen, 4.8 seconds behind Pastrana. That he could close the gap there with Pastrana taking that Joker lap, and he could get the lead.
Arpin's going to come back in, isn't he, into position with these guys. Yeah, Kevin could get it. Well, Timmy's in front of Kevin, 4.8. I'm trying to. Timmy's going to come out clearly back in front of Travis here. Travis comes back out onto the front straight. Arpin is only 3.1 behind. Arpin plus six is going to drop out behind the back of that battle, Jared. He's going to be in behind Speed, so he's kind of irrelevant too. It's really about where Travis finishes compared to Timmy. And I don't think there's going to be enough cars in between. The best lap, Timmy Hansen. He's pushing so hard.
Yeah, he said it earlier today. He says, I have nothing to lose. I'm having a great season. He's 16 points behind. He knows what he needs to do, but he's got a smile on his face. And I really think that at the end of this race, it's a big celebration for the sport of rallycross, especially here in the States. I mean, this is Nitro Rallycross is a brainchild, and Travis never thought there would be a legitimate series. This is as legitimate as it gets. Major manufacturers, star talent from all across the globe, and Travis Pastrana is leading it. And here we go, Coley. So, again, we are five laps. I mean, we're on the fifth lap of six. This is the longest we've seen of Nitro Rallycross this year. Again, being the longest, the most pavement, a lot of abuse.
Scott Speed and Timmy Hansen now are only a couple of cars apart, and so I think it's going to be close on. I think he needs extra cars in between, whether or not he can take that second place in the standings. But Pastrana on the dirt again. There's Arpin back up and over the top. Down onto the front straight again for Travis Pastrana.
I mean, 6.2 seconds is kind of the ideal. 4.7, that's too tight, man. Timmy Hansen is going to take the lead here. Travis goes for the Yokohama Tire Joker lap. Can he hold on to the lead? Or is Timmy Hansen going to get it back? Arpin goes for the Joker lap. Pastrana needs to be the quickest he's ever been through the Joker lap. And no, Timmy Hansen, Kevin Hansen, and now
Pastrana's
Speed.
He's behind Scott. He's going to be behind Scott Speed. Is he going to try and go around him? He can follow him to the line, remember. If he follows him to the line... Oh, there's only two cars in between. They needed one more car. The Hansons needed one more car in between for the points. So Travis Pastrana now can follow Scott Speed to the line. And if he's right behind him, they'll finish equal on points, but Travis will win on countback for number of wins.
That's right, because Travis Pastrana most recently won in Glen Helen. He won just before that back-to-back wins, Arizona and California. Scott Speed won back at ERX, so it defaults back to how many wins. And Pastrana has more wins. Timmy Hansen, Kevin Hansen, Speed, Pastrana. That's your one through four.
Masterful tactics from the Hansen squad. They were the first two winners of the first ever Nitro Rallycross events in 18 and 19. But this is the first time we've had a Nitro Rallycross championship. The sun sets here in Florida on a brilliant season. Hansen from Hansen for the win. But Travis Pastrana is going to follow his teammate Speed over the line. And he is your 2021 Nitro Rallycross champion.
I would be too. I got bumped and bumped me sideways. I couldn't get on the brakes. I really messed him up. I feel horrible, man.
And there it is. You can see Travis Pastrana talking so quickly, already elaborating on this race. He's not thinking about championship, but overall, unofficially, as you say, Pastrana over Speed. And there it is. So defaulting to the victories, as you called it, Andrew, Pastrana gets the win over that, and he gets 1 point over Timmy. So look at that. The shaping and the changing of the guards. Timmy Hansen's smile says it all. Getting that victory is a win in itself.
Of course it is. He lost the World Championship last week on countback, and he comes here to arguably, you know, the fastest growing, biggest rallycross championship in the world. Takes a win against the best rallycross drivers over here, and that will mean the world to Timmy. That's a great way for him to sign off on, potentially on his internal combustion career in rallycross. He takes a victory here.
Oh, that's great.
And Pastrana, turn one, look... Jared, you know, championships, they're often contentious. There's often that moment that decides it. There's going to be turn one. You wait to, you know, the comments and everybody getting involved. But Travis did a brilliant job. He got squeezed so hard in the first corner by Kevin. Let's see.
That was wild. I did not expect that. You know what? Maybe we did expect it. But there he is, Travis Pastrana getting outside of his vehicle. Scott Speed. And there they are. Scott Speed, the 41, taking off his gloves.
And Scott, hyped because Subaru wins the championship.
This is actually the first ever Drivers' Championship for Subaru Motorsport USA as well. Travis Pastrana, I think his teammate Scott Speed will hold on to P2 in the standings. Little chat between them.
Trying to eavesdrop on their conversation. Andrew, there it is, and there it is.
Travis Pastrana, yeah, finishes equal on points with his teammate Scott Speed. It goes on count back, and Pastrana, with more wins than Speed, takes the title.
I got smashed from Kevin.
A lot of discussion already. You know, it's like Senna Prost. It's like Bakker and Hansen. And now, you know, teammates, it's even more like Senna Prost. You know, Pastrana and Speed. Little hug there from Timmy taking the win from Travis, who's taken the championship.
So, again, they tied in points 219, but it defaults back to wins. And with the win, look, he says not just yet.
Okay, so...
I don't know. What's the tension here?
Turn one. Travis is wondering whether or not there's going to be a decision on turn one. I don't think he wants to take the trophy, but they're going to give it to him anyway.
There's some tension down here.
There is.
And now Travis takes over the trophy, and there it is. Travis, hold it up high. You are 2021 Nitro Rallycross Supercar Champion. Pilot of the Subaru, and that means 1 and 2. Pastrana first overall, Scott Speed and Timmy Hansen in third as he stands atop his trusty steed. Coley, still feeling that turn one.
Pastrana, what a brilliant year for him. He won the ARA Rally Championship. Now he wins Nitro Rallycross as well. It's the perfect season. He's come on so much as a rallycross driver this year. You've got to be aggressive. You've got to go for it. Yeah, he went. I think the steering wheel says you've got to want it. He wanted it. He went for it. He got it.
All right, let's throw it down to Will, who is down there. Congratulations to Travis Pastrana. Will, get on in there. Talk to our champion.
Travis. Are you okay? Congratulations. Hang on. More hugs going on here. Give us just one second. Travis, congratulations first and foremost. Unbelievable. Your first rallycross title. We know how much this means to you. But that did not go how the playbook had it written there. That was not seamless at all. At what point did you think, at any point did you think you got this done?
It all came down that it's been a tough year for the Hansons and for just decision making in general. We got smashed by Kevin coming in the first, which I would have done the same. And when he hit me, once you break loose on pay, I feel really bad for Scott coming in there. He mentored me all year. He did everything all year. He was the fastest at the race this year. So I don't know if it's official. That's awesome. I hate to have something go down like that. But I just want to say thank you to Subaru. Thank you to the fans. Thank you guys for coming out. This has been an absolutely amazing year. This was the most regular kind of track, and we definitely had the most carnage for sure. It was very difficult to pass on there, but I tell you, I love the firm. You guys have been awesome. Everyone down here in Florida, but just huge thanks to Yokohama, KMC, and Subaru, and huge thanks to Scott Speed for honestly getting me to even be close to this championship. And I know there's going to be some interesting things after this, but hopefully when everyone sees the footage, it is what it is. But anyway, I just want to say thank you. Just to be in the hunt for this championship, I was the fourth fastest all weekend, and we ended up fourth in the race. But I tell you, the Subaru crew did amazing, and we got that win in the heat race when we needed it. And I just want to thank everyone. It's been an amazing, amazing ride this year.
Thank you so much, Travis, and thank you to you and the whole team. It's been absolutely fantastic to watching you race all season long. We're going to go have a chat with Scott now. We'll just head down.
Holy smokey.
Scott, does...
Is that... Oh, that's cold.
Have some champagne.
Well, Will's going to make her way down and try and have a catch up with Scott, and we'll hear the other side of it. Travis is obviously thinking, just, you know, that's what happens when championships go down, isn't it?
you know, there can be only one overall winner, and it's accumulation of a season. It might have come down to this one race, but it's the four previous races. It's the bracket battles. It's the victory. It's a culmination. It's not just this one turn to rule them all.
It's the whole season.
Travis won the first two or the previous two rounds. Scott won round two. So all this, guess what? Travis Pastrana is your champion.
They were equal on points, as you said. Every single point. If one of them had missed one point in the qualifying stages at one event, it would have gone the other way. So, yeah, you're right. It's the accumulation of an entire season. The season's full of stuff. Things happen.
I know still for Scott. It's Scott.
Can we get another interview here? I'm still hot.
Okay, well, there you go. A lot of discussion carrying on.
Yeah, there's just some tension here in regards to what's going on. Big P, thank you for waving the flags this season. Yeah, he's down there, that gentleman next to Travis. He's the one who waves the flags. Here, let's take a look. Here we are in car.
Right, so Kevin has got Travis super hard. Wow, that's close.
He went up on two wheels.
Yeah, he did. He's still got two wheels on the tarmac. That's the difference between Timmy yesterday when he didn't have any wheels on. So watch it from the back. Kevin's moved across instantly. I expected that, Jared, because Travis was the one who had the most points advantage over Timmy. Therefore, Kevin has to try to make Travis's life difficult, put him further back in the pack and stick Timmy out in front. Just a word about the Hansons. You know, what incredible tactics from them to go P1 and P2 today.
So you see contact. Travis hits Kevin.
You know what else, Jared?
He rose up.
The dust from the cleanup on the inside line. There's a lot of dust on the inside when we were cleaning up from transmission fluid and stuff on the track earlier on. So Travis, as Kevin's got into him, and then as he's jumped on the brakes, that, you know, the wheels are locked, the grip levels are different than they were earlier. It's rallycross.
It's a perfect storm. It's a perfect storm of, again, that solvent being down, Kevin getting in. It rose up Pastrana on the left side. He comes down, ends up on two again.
Cool.
And I thought it was over for Scott when he went into the Joker lap.
Yeah, you said
he was slowing down
a little bit ago, but I think he got hit on the way in, looking at the drone shot from a moment ago. So much. Look at Timmy. Went so long on that jump. He's a weapon, Timmy is.
Yeah.
And so another win for him. That's his third Nitro Rallycross win. So we've had seven events, and that makes him the winningest driver in Nitro Rallycross, doesn't it?
If
you include 18 and 19, yeah.
Correct.
So that's his third Nitro Rallycross win.
Yeah.
So that's Travis, look. Coming in at the merge, in behind Scott. We knew that if he was in behind Scott, that he would take the title. That's all he had to do. It didn't actually matter where they were, other than if Timmy was further up the road. And I think that's what the Hansons are. Well, they're definitely smarter than us at spotting, Jared. And they dropped him in front of Kevin because they knew that would put a car between him and Scott. They were hoping, I'm guessing, that someone like Arpin would also have slotted in there. That might have given them the cars that they needed for Timmy to be able to take the title away. But the extra cars didn't come. Travis was exactly where he needed to be. He needed to be on the trunk of his teammate. If Scott was in front of him, he had a job to do. He got it done. They've won the manufacturer's title and their first ever driver's title in Rallycross.
Absolutely awesome.
Yeah, incredible performance from Subaru Motorsport USA.
Yeah, a great, like you said, first ever. And there it is. So Liza Markle giving him the trophy, saying, give the trophy, it's yours. And Travis takes it, and he earns it. Travis earned the championship of Nitro Rallycross. Nitro Rallycross Supercar, first ever champion. Let's throw it down to Will, who's down there with Timmy Hansen, our winner.
Timmy, let me face you around to the camera here. Congratulations, first and foremost, on that. That was about as perfectly executed for yourself and your brother as possible. What was the plan, and how well did it go for you both out there?
I guess we were coming into this championship fight in third place, and all we had to do was to win. Even better, take a first, second place, and then see how it all played out. We did the perfect weekend here. My car has been absolutely on point. Kevin did a fantastic race. I think he gave it up to me at that Joker merge. So, you know, this is just a huge team effort. We came through one and two, and it's a fantastic way to end this season. Of course, the Subaru guys did awesome. They have done all year, and they deserve the championship. So massive congrats to Travis, not just for today and wrapping it up, but for this whole year. He has been the one to beat at most races, and he has put this whole championship together. So I couldn't be happier for anyone.
Thank you so much, and congratulations again to both of you. Thank you.
Well said. Well said there by Timmy Hansen. Again, just you know, changing his tune a little bit from yesterday. And everybody wants to win, but there can only be one, either in the race or overall championship, accumulation of all those points. So as we're still going to keep on partying, don't go anywhere. Timmy Hansen did it, and there he is. Timmy Hansen, Kevin Hansen, Scott Speed, and with Travis Pastrana with that result, he is your champ. When we come back, the awards ceremony, don't go anywhere. We're going to continue partying like we did all year. Nitro Rallycross here at the Firm at North Florida. Again, come on back. Let's party.
From the mind of action sports icon, Travis Pastrana.
I mean, this is the only course in the world where cars literally fly.
Comes the next evolution in motorsports.
That almost landed on Hansen.
This is our Super Bowl. This is our Daytona 500, our Stanley Cup playoff game.
Spectacular purpose-built courses.
Decided to build one of the wildest tracks ever.
Incredible locations, from the desert to the snow. Huge jumps.
Wow, it's like they're launching out of a machine gun.
And drama at every turn.
This is literally the best, the wildest rallycross in the existence of the history of rallycross.
Welcome to Nitro Rallycross.
What an exciting season. It all kicked off in Utah, at Utah Motorsports Campus. And there is Travis making his way over to the podium. I'm going to join him over there. We're going to give out some trophies, both for next a phenomenal season as well as just overall celebrating. So, hey, hats off to Chase Elliott, too. I see the ZipRecruiter shirt there. So Chase Elliott, our 2020 NASCAR champion, joining us here. He did really well. He made the final. Of course, he finished last, but
that doesn't matter. He was in the final, wasn't he? And he learned a lot, and he had a great time. And I hope we get to see more people in the ZipRecruiter Go Nitro car. You know, my list, I want to see Valentino Rossi come and have a go at this. I want to see Kimi Raikkonen come and have a go. Anyone you got in mind? Any of the FD guys, maybe?
Yeah, drifters. I'd like to see, you know, Chris Forsberg, Ryan Turk, Vaughn Jr., Frederick Osbo.
Who retired this year? A couple of guys.
Vaughn Jr.
Yeah, okay. That's what I mean. So, you know, Rossi, Raikkonen, come on, get amongst it. We'll get them on the list. We'll get onto ZipRecruiter and say we've got some ideas for next year.
So there you can see, that's Travis's mom. Congratulatory hug. We'll see you at the podium. But, again, it's not just this round. It's five rounds. Kicking things off in Utah, a very sandy, dusty track for us, but that's where it all kicked off a couple years ago. And as you said, Hansen, the most winningest of Nitro Rallycross, as we had single events, part of Nitro Games, and then now the 2021 season kicking off this five-stop championship.
First ever championship, mate. 10 weeks, five events, and we're done. Like, it's been an absolute whirlwind. I was like, going to get emotional for a minute, just say a few thank yous to everyone. It's been brilliant, hasn't it? The people who put this together so quickly, the guys in the TV truck who have been behind. Yeah, we're lucky we get to shout at stuff, but working with you, mate, it's been a pleasure. But the racing, the tracks, it's by far exceeded my expectations. I had big expectations because of what these guys have done before, but to see the big tracks and to see the great racing, it's been so much fun. So yeah, forgive me for the happy clappy speech, but what a great time, mate. What a great time.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. Absolute pleasure working with you. And again, this is coming from an announcer. Action speaks louder than words, and we just put an exclamation point on it, right? And just overall, the personalities, the driving, the manufacturers, the companies who support the championship overall, and the fans either online on NBC Peacock or YouTube. And there's Arpin handing him a cold boy, and Scott Speed joining him down there as well.
I don't. Either way, Subaru.
And Subaru wins the Manufacturers Championship. And the fans either in the building or, again, watching on Peacock on NBC or on YouTube worldwide.
So much interaction. That's another thing. You know, you guys have got so stuck into, you know, the hashtag Go Nitro. Give us the hashtag Go Nitro. Let us know what you thought about today. You know, what did you think about the tracks this year? We'd love to hear from you guys. It's going to be bigger and better next year, you know?
I started behind you, but I promise you I was on the outside by the time you got smashed. I saw the shit going down.
Yeah, no.
I would have run that.
There's a bit of awkwardness there, but it's not, you know, people win and people lose. Nobody likes it. You like it when you win, but
no, I'm just thinking of the championship and how you got penalized yesterday.
And this is how close it was. It was a tie. It was a tie as far as points go, and that's why bracket battles are so important.
Timmy Hansen was 1 point behind. Imagine if it had been a three-way tie. I don't even think we knew it wouldn't be because of the score he was on yesterday, right. But my God, my head might have melted.
Yeah.
It was complicated. And trying to figure out the tactics, aren't the Hansons good at that? You know, dropping Timmy in with Kevin and making sure that the gap was there to slot other cars into, but... Yeah, Team Subaru winning the manufacturer's title, equal points at the top. I mean, three drivers within 1 point, Jared.
Steve Arpin finishing top five, Tanner Faust sixth, Larson Bakkerud, who failed to make a couple rounds of competition, still top 10. Frazier McConnell flying the Jamaican flag, has a bunch of fans here, and you can see Timmy and Travis wrapping out here still.
We've created some new characters here, haven't we? You know,
absolutely.
Frazier McConnell now is in the big eye of motorsport fans as a driver who's really fast. If you weren't, maybe you weren't familiar with some of the Europeans, the Ericssons, you know, those guys, they're right up there. There have been so many people that could have won these events. It's been a brilliant year for Subaru, but I've just, yeah, what a season. Sun setting over the trees in the background, and I'm feeling pretty cool.
It's feeling great. Time for us to give out some trophies down on the podium on behalf of the whole team here at Nitro Rallycross. Thank you so much, Andrew Coley, Will, Trevor Pirana, Street Bike Tommy, Katie Osborne, our whole Action Pack crew. Let's keep the party going. We'll see you next year. We'll see you online, or we'll see you another time. Let's go party on the podium. My name's Jared D'Anda. Thank you so much, and we'll see you next year. Send it! Nitro Rallycross is a wrap for the 2021 season.
How about it?